Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
We are here to start the induction process for the new joinees and anybody who wants to take this training. So we are starting with the training for life insurance today. So what are we going to learn in this training is the basics of life insurance. We're going to start with the basics of life insurance. So by the end of this session, I will explain to you the concept of insurance, the need for insurance, and the advantages and limitations of insurance, and the types of products that are available in life insurance. So let's start with concept of insurance. So insurance basically works on four basic concepts, which are control, there is avoid, there is retain, and there is transfer. So these are the four basic principles on which insurance works. So control is where, like the example here shows that when we have a car and there comes a traffic light, so we stop over there. So what are we doing? We're controlling any kind of an accident that can happen. In case we do not stop there, there is a likelihood that an accident can occur. So we are controlling ourselves and we are stopping over there. So that is controlling the risk. Second is avoiding the risk. So what does that mean? Is we avoid the risk altogether. We do not take out our car at all. So if we do not take out the car at all, there is no chance of an accident. So that is obviously not a practical option. If you have a car, you are going to be taking it out. So that is not an option that we have. Retain is the third option, where in case there is an accident, then we will bear the cost of the repairs or any kind of damages that are done to the car. So there is retain, and the next one is transfer. Transfer is that we know there is a likelihood of an accident at some point of time, if at all, and we are transferring that risk to a third party. Here it's going to be the insurance company. So these are the four basic principles of insurance. Now we come to how insurance works. So what happens in insurance is that it is a contribution of many people, which is collected into a pool and it is shared by so many people. So what happens exactly is that suppose there are 100 people who are wanting to take an insurance. So the likelihood that all 100 will suffer a damage is probably not possible, right? But we are contributing, all 100 people are contributing a certain amount of premium. That pool is collected, and out of that, say 2 people or 3 people suffer damages. So those are the 2 people, 3 people who are going to get redeemed from that pool of money that was collected from those 100 people. So this is the basic concept of insurance. In life insurance, there can be 3 types of losses. There's disability, there's death, and there's accident. So the most basic concept, like I just told you all, is the contribution of many people, which where the premium paid by all will be pooled up, and the losses suffered by a few. In life insurance, it could be disability, death, or accident, and the few that suffer these disabilities or whatever will be paid from the pool of money that was collected.
How is disability different from accident?
Disability could also due to be medical reasons, like say paralysis, a paralytic attack, so which may not necessarily be due to accident. So in such a case also there are policies which pay the insured person some kind of money back or whatever, you know, depending on the kind of policy that has been taken, even disability is paid. Okay, so this we have already done. Here, so can be understood with an example over here, where we are talking about 3,000 houses, each costing 10 lakh rupees, of which 10 houses get burnt. So the total compensation required will be 1 lakh each. So 10 lakhs is the total compensation required. There are 3,000 houses, out of which we are talking about 10 houses that got burnt. Suppose they cost 1 lakh each. So the total contribution required to get them back into the state they were in would be 10 lakh rupees. So what is the proportion that each person has to pay? So the probability that one person has to pay is the 10 over 3000 into the loss amount, that is 10 lakhs. So contribution of each person becomes 333 rupees only. So if 3000 people in a society were living, and if suppose there was a fire and 10 houses got burnt, contribution of everybody would be 333 rupees, but those 10 houses would get 1 lakh each. So total compensation of 10 lakhs would have been paid. So,
but you have not factored in the cost towards maintaining this pool, which means the insurance company have administrative charges.
So that will be very minimal. So say instead of 333, it becomes 350 rupees or maybe 375 rupees, you know. But still, if you see it in the larger picture, you're only having to pay 375 rupees a year, and in case there was a fire, you would have gotten back 1 lakh rupees. So that is exactly how the principle of insurance works. So of course, those all the charges, everything is included in the premium that the insured person pays, be it any kind of charge. And but still, in effect, you will see that of course it's a lot less for the risk that they are underwriting. So here the larger the population, of course the probability or the contribution of each person would become lesser and lesser. Now, we come to the next concept, which is risk transfer. Now, what is risk transfer? Is we have to have two parties, one which is willing to transfer the risk, the other which is willing to underwrite the risk. So, it's not just that I go to the insurance company and say, ki I want to insure maybe my flower bed, you know. So, they have to be willing to underwrite that particular risk. It's not like I want to insure anything under the sun and they are going to be willing to insure it. They have to be willing, I have to be willing to transfer the risk. So both parties have to be agreeable, only then the transfer of risk happens. So creating a pool of the individual risk and applying the principle of large numbers. So for an insurance company, till there is a large number of people wanting the similar risk, they are never going to be able to underwrite that particular risk. If there are only say 5 people who want to insure their flower beds, they're obviously, because the law of averages is what works in insurance, so they're not going to be able to underwrite that particular risk because there are not enough takers for that policy. We come to underwriting and what is the concept of underwriting. So we can sort of take underwriting just like an airport security system. So when we go to an airport also, first what are they going to do is screen our baggage. You know, they put it under a screener, a screening system, and they check the baggage, and then they kind of certify whether you are fit to travel or not fit to travel. So similarly, in life insurance also, they are going to underwrite if a person is fit to be taken into that pool or not. So underwriting or selection is the process of verifying the level of risk each new entrant brings in. An underwriter is an employee of the insurer, and he determines the premium to be charged based on his assessment of the risk. So, based on the assessment of a person that the insurance company does, they will kind of agree or not agree to underwrite that particular risk. So, how first and foremost would be they review the various factors that are related to the life being considered. So, they are going to consider factors like the person's eating habits, their drinking habits, what kind of a job the person is in, all because all these factors are related to the risk involved with insuring that particular person. The next would be determining the impact of the factors of probability of dying. So based on the lifestyle of the person, what is the probability of that particular person dying? Like say, consider a person who is the age of 20 versus a person who is age of 55. So of course, the risk of dying for a person of age 55 is far more than that of a person who is age 20. So they are going to consider all these factors before underwriting and deciding on what premium can be charged for that particular person. Evaluate the total impact of the various hazards on his life. Like say, suppose somebody is in a hazardous job, say mining. So the chances of that person dying is going to be far more than somebody who is at a desk job. So again, that will play a role in assessing the impact on the life of the person, and then decide on the life's admission into the pool and the terms of admission. So if everything is standard, then they will get admitted into the pool on standard terms and conditions. But in case there is something that is not as per standard norms and conditions, then they might decline or not take in the person at all in the pool, or they might charge extra premium for that person.
So extra premium is loading.
Yes. So suppose somebody is suffering from diabetes. So when they do a medical test of the person and they अगर नॉर्मल पर्सन है तो सपोज 20,000 आपका प्रीमियम आ रहा था, पर अगर उसको डायबिटीज है तो इट्स पॉसिबल दे से कि 20,000 में हम आपका अंडर राइट नहीं कर सकते, आपका लोडिंग लगेगा, आपको 10,000 रुपए एक्स्ट्रा देने पड़ेंगे।
ये जो 10,000 है ये डिसाइड जो होगा वो आपका
इंश्योरेंस कंपनी डिसाइड करती है, बिकॉज दैट विल एंटायरली डिपेंड ऑन द मेडिकल कंडीशन ऑफ द पर्सन एंड द एज ऑफ द पर्सन। कि आज एक बहुत यंग पर्सन को सपोज डायबिटीज है तो उसके लिए रिस्क जो स्पैन है देयर कवरिंग द स्पैन दैट देयर कवरिंग फॉर इज गोइंग टू बी फार वाइडर देन समबडी हु इज ओल्डर। तो वो उसके सब चीज को देख के असेस करके ये, क्योंकि इसीलिए जेनेरिक नहीं हो सकता है ये, जिस आदमी का स्कैनिंग हो रहा है, जिसका प्रपोजल है उसके बेसिस पे, उसके मेडिकल टेस्ट के बेसिस पे ही वो डिसाइड होता है कि कितना लोडिंग आ सकता है। सो देन वी कम टू द प्रिंसिपल्स ऑफ इंश्योरेंस। What are, so again, the principles of insurance, we have four principles: essentials of a contract, utmost good faith, insurable interest, and indemnity. So we will understand each principle a little more in detail. So what are the essentials of a contract? So the Contract Act of 1872 was written in India by the Government of India. And it governs that a contract is an agreement between two or more parties enforceable by law. So it is a contract only if anything that is enforceable by law will be called a contract. Something that you and I decide between the two of us and which is not enforced by law will not be called a contract. आज हो सकता है मैं आपके साथ कुछ एक deal करती हूँ और हम decide करते हैं कि okay I am going to sell you something, maybe my laptop, and you are going to pay me 30,000 rupees. But if it is not enforced by law, it is not a contract. It is just probably a deal between the two of us. It's not a contract. If we get it enforced by law, then it becomes a contract. So, what some examples are: contract of sale of land, that will be a contract. But contract, if somebody undertakes to maybe kill a person or hurt a person, that will of course not be a contract because that is not enforceable by law. The lease and license agreements will be contracts. Contracts to steal money from a bank will not be a contract.
Fourth one, kya tha?
Contract to steal money from a bank. So of course, you know, that cannot be enforced by law, so that cannot be a contract. So then, what are the essentials to a contract? So there are four parts that are actually involved. Who is the insurance company? Who is writing the contract? The insurance company. What does he do? He promises to pay a certain sum of money. To whom? To the policyholder. When? On happening of a specific contingency. So specific contingency in life insurance would be either death or maturity of the policy. So the basic two things in a life insurance contract would be that either if it's the money is payable on death or if the policy matures.
What happens?
Sorry?
If there is a permanent disablement.
Yes, so if that is part of the policy, on detection of that permanent disability, whatever money is to be paid, that will be paid. So of course that depends, you know, so whatever is payable as per the contract will be paid to the insured person, whether it's death, but the two main things will be either death or maturity of the policy. In between there are many add-ons that are added in life insurance, like critical illness maybe, or accident could be there, there could be a total disability, there could be a partial disability. All these are add-ons which are payable as per the contract of the policy. So now the essentials would be, of course there has to be an offer, which when we go to the insurance company, so there is an offer that they make and it has to be accepted for a consideration. Consideration would be of course the premium that the person is paying. Then he has to be in capacity to contract. So what that means is that a person who is not of age, who is below the age of 18, of course is not in a capacity to contract because he's a minor. So the capacity to contract, and again an invalid person or a mad person, they are not in a capacity to make a contract. So those people will not be able to take a contract, life insurance policy. Then consensus ad idem, matlab ki aapko both parties have to be consenting on the terms and conditions of the policy. Me as a person should know what I'm getting in the policy. The insurance company is supposed to specify in the policy document what they are giving to me. And that has to be, of course, in consent with both of them and us. Legality of object, of course, because it's a contract, there has to be a legality of object in it. and it is bound legally. Whatever is written in the contract, they are bound to give that to us legally. In case they differ from what they have written in the contract, then of course we can go to the courts and we can file a case against them. Capacity to perform and intention to create legal relationship. Capacity to perform again would be, here comes the financial evaluation of a person. Like suppose I am trying to take a policy of premium 5 lakhs every year. But my earning, but what I am showing in my ITR or my books or whatever, I am showing an earning of only 2 lakhs every year. So where is the capacity to pay the premium in that case? So they evaluate the financials of a person, and only if there is capacity, then they allow the policy to be written. Otherwise, it cannot be written. And intention to create legal relationship, it's not, so what that means is that it should, if a policy is for a term of 20 years, there has to be intention of continuing that policy for about 20 years. So of course nobody can give a guarantee that a person will continue it, but that intention should be there. That has to be validated by the insurance company.
वो कैपेबिलिटी ऑफ परफॉर्मेंस जो आपने कहा, वो इंश्योरेंस कंपनी जज करके उसके बाद 2 लाख का आईटीआर है और 5 लाख का अगर प्रीमियम देता है, ऐसे काफ़ी लोग हैं जिनका आईटीआर शायद आप भी जानते हैं जब इस लाइन में, तो जिनका आईटीआर 2 लाख और 3 लाख का है, लेकिन दे आर पेइंग वन टाइम प्रीमियम 5 लाख इन ईयर और
वन टाइम प्रीमियम वाले में प्रॉब्लम नहीं होती है, क्योंकि हम वन टाइम एक चेक दे रहे हैं तो मेरे को दोबारा तो पे करना नहीं है।
थ्री इयर्स का ऐसा कुछ होता है, थ्री इयर्स आपको उसको मेंटेन करना है।
हाँ, वो तो है, बट इनिशियली व्हाइल अंडरराइटिंग द पॉलिसी, अगर वो देखती है कि आपकी कैपेसिटी नहीं है वो 3 साल भी पे करने के लिए, तो वो कैसे राइट करेगी ना, बिकॉज दे आर ऑल गवर्न्ड बाय IRDA. सो दीज आर द बेसिक मेन मोस्ट बेसिक नॉर्म्स कि अगर कैपेसिटी नहीं है अगर बंदे की आईटीआर में नहीं दिख रहा उतना पैसा, तो वो नहीं अलाउ करेगी आपको अंडरराइट करने के लिए. Unless you are able to show some other kind of income, you know, if you can show some kind of capacity where you will be able to pay that kind of premium, whatever policy you
take. Yeah, इसमें इस तरह से ये, लेकिन इस तरह इसमें क्या probability है कि husband wife दोनों का IT को साथ में,
हाँ कई बार होता है वो consider कर सकते हैं कि
case to case,
हाँ case to case basis पे होगा वो, अगर मिला के अगर आपका दिखता है कि हाँ pay कर सकते हैं तो they might allow it, that will again become very case to case. बट ऑफकोर्स ओवरऑल आपका वो कैपेसिटी दिखना चाहिए कि आप उसका प्रीमियम पे कर सकते हैं. सो नाउ वी मूव टू द डिफरेंस बिटवीन एसेंशियल्स ऑफ इन एसेंशियल्स ऑफ कॉन्ट्रैक्ट. वी मूव टू द डिफरेंस बिटवीन कॉन्ट्रैक्ट एंड एन इंश्योरेंस कॉन्ट्रैक्ट. सो एनी कॉन्ट्रैक्ट लाइक अ लैंड डीड और सेल, सो दैट इज अ कॉन्ट्रैक्ट विच इज इन्फोर्सेबल बाय लॉ, सो दैट्स अ कॉन्ट्रैक्ट. बट वॉट इज द डिफरेंस बिटवीन दैट काइंड ऑफ अ कॉन्ट्रैक्ट एंड एन इंश्योरेंस कॉन्ट्रैक्ट. कॉन्ट्रैक्ट, इंश्योरेंस कॉन्ट्रैक्ट में नॉर्मल जॉब का कॉन्ट्रैक्ट है वो तो है ही, उसके अलावा दो बहुत इंपॉर्टेंट चीजें होती हैं, प्रिंसिपल ऑफ इंश्योरेबल इंटरेस्ट एंड प्रिंसिपल ऑफ अटमोस्ट गुड फेथ. सो आई जस्ट एक्सप्लेन दैट इन लिटिल मोर डिटेल. सो कॉन्ट्रैक्चुअल फाइनेंशियल इंस्टीट्यूशंस प्रोवाइड अ सम ऑफ मनी व्हिच इज जनरली गारंटीड अंडर अ कॉन्ट्रैक्ट. लाइफ इंश्योरेंस इन्वॉल्व्स अ कॉन्ट्रैक्ट वेयर अ पर्सन देयर इज अ कॉन्ट्रैक्ट बिटवीन द लाइफ इंश्योरेंस कंपनी and an insured person. And a life insurance contract is an agreement that the insurer will pay the insured a sum of money called the sum assured on happening of a specific event, usually the death of the insured or the survival of the insured to the end of a specific term. Like I told you earlier also, so what exactly in an insurance contract, the insurance company and we have the insured person. So the insurance company is promising to pay a certain sum of money to the insured person in an eventuality of a death or to the maturity of the particular policy. So this is the flow of how an insurance contract works. There's a proposer. Proposer will be the insured person who is proposing to the insurance company ki mujhe ye policy leni hai. Proposal form hum ek offer denge insurance company ko. Fir wo either usko accept karegi to पॉलिसी अंडरराइट होने जाएगी. अगर वो नहीं कहती है, अगर मेरे सब कुछ इवैल्यूएट करने के बाद माय फाइनेंशियल्स माय हेल्थ एवरीथिंग वो कहती है कि नहीं आपकी हेल्थ इज नॉट एज ऑन अ स्टैंडर्ड अंडरराइटिंग नहीं हो सकती है इसमें, दे माइट गिव मी एन काउंटर ऑफर, दे माइट से कि आपको एक्स्ट्रा लोडिंग देना पड़ेगा. अगर वो मेरे लिए ऑलराइट है, इफ आई एम गोइंग टू बी अग्रीएबल ऑन दैट एक्स्ट्रा लोडिंग दैट दे गिविंग मी, then the policy contract is completed and it goes on into underwriting. Otherwise, it goes into cancellation. If that loading is not acceptable to me, then the policy goes into cancellation. And once the policy is issued, there is a free look period of 15 days Once the insured person receives the policy document, he has 15 days to cancel the policy in case he feels that the terms and conditions or anything in the policy document is not as per what he had wanted. कई बार क्यों ये चीज क्यों दिया आईआरडीए ने आप, क्योंकि कई बार क्या होता है कि एजेंट्स लोग सब कुछ अपने आप भर देते हैं, इंश्योर्ड पर्सन को पता नहीं होता है कि क्या लिखा है, क्या वो कुछ कुछ भी बोल के वो मिससेलिंग कर देते हैं. हाँ, मिससेलिंग कर देते हैं. सो अ पर्सन, द इंश्योर्ड पर्सन, आफ्टर रिसीविंग द डॉक्यूमेंट्स, ही हैज 15 डेज टू आइदर एक्सेप्ट कीप द पॉलिसी और से दैट आई वांट टू कैंसिल द पॉलिसी. इन दैट सच अ केस द एंटायर प्रीमियम अमाउंट इज रिफंडेड टू द
एनी चार्जेस.
No, generally they do not deduct any charges.
Within 15 days.
Yes, within 15 days, cool off period जो है आपका, उसमें कोई charges deduct नहीं होता है. Possible.
I remember.
Yes.
I had taken out a policy from HDFC Life.
Okay.
And upon receiving the document, certain clauses which were there was to which I was not comfortable.
Okay. With. Okay.
I had gone for a free look cancellation.
Okay.
But unfortunately, I did not receive the full amount.
And did they give you a reason as to why not?
At that point of time, I was abroad.
Oh, okay.
So I wrote a mail from abroad because I was working there. I could not come to India.
Okay.
And in, I only came to know that this amount of money has been transferred into my bank. I used to have access to my net banking.
Okay.
And because the amount was not significant, maybe 2,000 or 3,000 rupees.
So sometimes what happens is that the medical charges, you know, the medical test that you had undergone, it's possible that some insurance companies.
There was no medical charge.
Okay.
I don't know, but however, this is what I knew.
Okay.
That upon during the free look period, if there is a cancellation, the entire amount gets refunded.
Yes, it does. In general, that is what gets refunded. Some companies might just deduct the medical charges, if at all. But other than that, there are no charges that should be deducted by the insurance company.
Right.
Yes. So I'm sure if you had pursued it, and either they would have given you a reason as to why it has been deducted, or they would have returned that. They would have refunded that money as well.
I had called that agent from HDFC Bank.
Okay.
The person I spoke to him on WhatsApp, and what he said that the stamp duty, which was levied on the policy.
Okay, that is what they deducted.
They have deducted that.
Okay, possible, maybe, not too sure of that. Okay. Okay. So now we come to the second principle, which is utmost good faith. So
it is called iuverima fidei.
Sorry?
In Latin,
yes,
it is called iuverima fidei.
Yes. So so ordinary commercial contracts are governed by the principle of scabie tempter. It implies that the buyer must check the details of the goods being bought and not just go by what the seller is selling. So what that means is that when a normal contract takes place, like suppose I am buying maybe a house, a property from you. So I am supposed to go visit that property, see everything. वो जितना मुझे बोल रहा है क्या है नहीं है वो मैं अपने आप check करूँगी. Because once the deal is done, then I am not going to be in any position to go and ask him. You told me so much, but it's only this much, you know. So it's my duty to check everything that I am buying, whether it is incorrect or is there anything that is missing, you know. So that is my duty. So that is what is called the principle of caveat emptor. However, caveat emptor does not so. So caveat emptor means buyer beware and buyer beware of the seller. The whatever, so I as a buyer have to be aware of what the seller is selling me. It's my duty. I cannot just go by the word of the seller and usne mujhe bol diya ki 2000 square feet hai aur maine uski baat maan li. I will probably go and get it measured. Wo 1800 nikalta hai ki 2100 nikalta hai wo baad mein dekhenge, you know, wo depend karta hai. Principle of good faith should be observed in the transaction. However, insurance deals are not governed by the principle of caveat emptor. So what that means is, here it is the duty of the person who's taking the policy to declare everything, and it is the duty of the insurance company to declare everything that they are giving you the policy. So what that means is, like, say let's for example take a situation where I want a term insurance. I have gone to the insurance company. Meri 10 saal pehle ek appendicitis ki operation hui thi, par ab इंश्योरेंस कंपनी को कैसे पता चलेगा कि मेरी कोई ऑपरेशन हुई है, अनलेस आई टेल देम. और अगर मैं वो नहीं बताती हूँ, इट विल बी मिसरिप्रेजेंटेशन, बिकॉज आई एम knowingly not telling them that mere ye tha ya mujhe diabetes hai ya hypertension hai. Kuch cheeze to uncover ho jati when they do medical tests, but some things they're not going to go through my entire body scan and get every part checked ki sab theek hai ki nahi hai, you know. It is my duty to tell them ki agar mera kabhi hospitalization hua tha koi bhi karan se, if any surgery had happened at any point of time, so this is my duty to tell the insurance company. And what is the insurance company's duty is for them to tell us what is part of the policy, what you are going to get, when you are going to get, how much you are going to get, you know. So it's, they cannot have anything in hidden language. They have to have everything very clear out in front of the insured person ki aapko policy mein ye 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 milega. So principle of caveat emptor does not apply in case of insurance. These contracts are governed by the principle of utmost good faith or ubermae fides.
Can you I'm yet to understand what the significance of caveat emptor.
Mm-hmm.
Can you emphasize on this?
So which is what that I in a normal contract, when there are two parties involved, they both have to be aware of each other, and whatever you see something and you buy something, so you see it in entirety and then buy it. But in insurance company, like I just explained, that it is impossible for the insurance company to check every part, because we are talking about life insurance here. It is not possible for them to check your entire body as to whether all your organs are there, all are functioning well. There are some basic medical tests that they get done for you. You know, they'll have a routine blood examination. They'll have a routine urine test. They'll have maybe like a sonography done. Maybe they'll have a cardiogram done, depending on what you declare. So if I don't declare anything, they will have the very basic done. And depending on age also, the medical grid gets triggered as per the age of the person. So somebody who's 25 years of age and has not declared anything, that he does not have diabetes, he does not have hypertension, or no surgeries, no nothing. So insurance company is going to probably not do any medical test for him and just write the policy. But if that gets uncovered at a later point of time, that will become a problem. Because you haven't declared anything. So caveat emptor here is that caveat emptor means that be aware of what you're selling. So which is why caveat emptor does not apply to life insurance. It is my duty to declare as an insured person. It is the insurance company's duty to tell me what I'm going to get in the policy.
One thing, while entering into a contract,
mm-hmm.
one has to fill up a proposal.
Right.
Okay. Whether you had this, whether you had that, so many
right.
histories
right.
are asked, and
right.
we can say either yes or no.
Yes, yes.
Okay. There are certain things which may have happened,
mm-hmm.
which is not there in the proposal form.
Okay.
And upon taking of the policy,
mm-hmm.
the person suffers from that particular disease
mm-hmm.
or
mm-hmm.
ailment.
Mm-hmm.
Can the insurance company take a plea that you were aware but you did not
see get? So generally in a proposal form they will have everything specified. Did you
generally,
have to go
generally, but
yes, so it is pretty inclusive, you know. So all the problems that are large or can have a bearing on a person's life, they generally include that, and then they will have probably like say three lines left at the bottom saying if there's anything else please declare. So over there, if you declare, if there is anything which is missed out in the questions, then you should declare it over there. If it has any kind of a bearing on the person's life, that is something that needs to be declared. And anyhow, there is a contract. There is a what do we say law where after 3 years of the policy being in force, the insurance company cannot bring anything in question. So if 3 years have passed in your policy document, in your policy, then the insurance company cannot come back to ask you any questions as to why this happened and why you did not declare. So 3 years निकल गए हैं तो आपको वो उसको देना ही पड़ेगा. Unless there was misrepresentation, like in a term insurance, suppose कि you like so many times somebody is a smoker and has not declared himself as a smoker to get better rates, you know. And if at a later point it gets uncovered that before taking the policy the person was already a smoker. Then there is a chance that they will say that the claims will not be payable, you know. So if there is misrepresentation, then there is a chance that the claim will not be payable. Other than that, within 3 years insurance company can call upon the insured for any kind of details, but after that they cannot call upon the insured.
Like you are in the health insurance,
right.
what is pre-existing remains excluded for 3 years.
Yes.
And in the from 4th year onward, this gets automatically covered.
Right.
And any contraction with that ailment will entail that the claim is paid because of payment.
Yes. 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 So that's the waiting
but
period.
That is
the varies from company to company. Some take it on right away. Some have a waiting period of 2 years. Some 3 years. Some 4 years. Depends from company to company.
No, but recently IRDA has said that irrespective of what type of policy, health policy you are writing, all ailments which have been pre-existing will have to be covered mandatorily from 4th year onward.
Okay.
This is there is a circular.
7th year, no? 4th
year.
4th year. So maximum waiting period becomes 4 years basically, yes.
No. 3 years is the maximum.
4th year it will get
year, it gets automatically covered.
Okay. So, of course then, it's the duty to disclose like we just discussed. It's the duty of the insured person to disclose every detail which has a bearing on his life and accurately and correctly. So, so not providing correct information amounts to misrepresentation.
What happens is that at the time of filling of the claim, proposal form, what I have seen that without asking the insurer, the agent fills up the form, no, everywhere.
Yes, yes.
Okay. And at the time of claim, when the proposal was scrutinized, it was found that it is said as no.
Yes.
This is a kind of a misrepresentation.
Absolutely, absolutely.
And this has
this is mis-selling rather than misrepresentation because probably the insurer doesn't even know those questions were answered as no by the agent, you know.
That is why it is, I think it is important for the
insurer to fill up the proposal. Yes, we always stress on the fact that please declare correctly and please fill up the form yourself. Mm-hmm. But what happens is if many people, you know, if HNI clients are there, whatever, they don't have the time to actually sit down and fill up a form or whatever, you know. So it is our duty to at least fill it up correctly for them. First preference is that the insured fills it up themselves. In case they're not in a position to do so, at least get the correct data and fill up the forms correctly. So that at the time of a claim, there is no kind of a reputation. Fully, we need to disclose fully. Every detail about our life, we have to disclose fully. And not providing full information amounts to non-disclosure. And material facts, that facts related to the risk. Anything that has a bearing on my life will be a material fact. So if I had an accident where something, maybe I broke some bones, which might have a bearing on my life at a later stage, is also relevant and has to be. I mean, some people, you know, there are people who come to us and say that I had probably epilepsy, maybe 15 years ago, got treated at that point of time, and today I'm hale and hearty, so I don't want to declare that. But what can happen is, in such a case, something like epilepsy, it might come up again, you know, maybe 20 years later or 25 years later. Or maybe some other related disease can happen because of that particular disease. So if you have not declared it, then again you're liable, the insurance company will say that you did not declare, so your claim will not be payable. So we generally, we try and extract out of the client everything, you know. Because what happens is, they also kind of tend to forget. कि अगर 20 साल हो गए अपेंडिसाइटिस जैसी चीज है अगर उसका ऑपरेशन था पीपल डोंट इवन रिमेंबर कि कब हुआ था हो सकता है 30 साल 25 साल हो गए हैं एंड दे आर एब्सोल्युटली फाइन टुडे सो दे जस्ट हैपन टू नॉट टेल अस द डिटेल्स सो वी हैव टू बी द वंस टू एक्सट्रैक्ट ऑल द डिटेल्स आउट ऑफ देम सो दैट ऑल फैक्ट्स आर डिक्लेयर्ड करेक्टली सो फीचर्स ऑफ अटमोस्ट गुड फेथ विल बी इट अप्लाइज टू ऑल इंश्योरेंस कॉन्ट्रैक्ट्स लाइफ और नॉन लाइफ it is compulsory to be a part of the insurance contract. Both the parties must disclose the truth and they both cannot hide facts or distort facts. You cannot even distort facts because it will have a bearing on the claims at a later point of time. So, life insurance, what happens in case there is non-compliance of the principle of utmost good faith? So the contract may be declared invalid. So they might just completely declare it invalid, not pay the claims, non-payment of policy benefits or non-refund of all premiums paid under policy. So there's a possibility that they might completely call it invalid and refund the premiums, or they might not pay the claims, or they might not even refund the premiums paid and up to the point that the policyholder has paid. So now we come to how a person's life expectancy matters. The state of his health, habits, personal history and family history. These are all material facts for a person. So every person has a life expectancy based on his personal habits, his personal history, family history and state of his own health. Like say a person who is weighs 90 kgs versus a person who weighs 60 kgs. Of course, the person who weighs 90 kgs is probably, you know, is going to suffer from more diseases, probably die earlier than somebody who's fit and weighs only 60 kgs, you know. So all a person's personal habits and everything, or his family history again. Family history may, suppose there's maybe father or mother had cancer. So something that passes down genes can have a bearing on a person. So they even ask the family's history. So if there is a history of cancer in a person's family, they are going to probably, you know, be stricter in underwriting for that person versus a person who has no cancer in their family at all. So every circumstance that would have a bearing on the judgment of a prudent insurer in fixing the premium or determining the acceptability of the proposal for insurance is a material fact. So here, that's what the advice that we always give to people is that please declare all facts correctly, please fill up the forms correctly, so that in future there is no case of repudiation of a claim when the claim arises. So what are examples of a material fact? Age, height, weight and build of a person. Like I just said, if somebody has a high BMI, maybe insurance company does not even underwrite that policy altogether. Versus somebody who has a normal or average BMI. Occupation of life assured will have a bearing. Somebody who is on a desk job versus somebody who has a field job. The person on a field job will obviously have more chances of an accident. More maybe he's exposed to more hazardous substances. So somebody in mining or a chemical industry will have more hazardous substances and more chances of dying early. Personal habits like drinking, smoking will have a bearing on somebody's health. Past and current policies. How do past and current policies affect a person is at every stage a person has a maximum sum assured that the person can have. So at the age of 40, suppose I have a maximum eligibility of say 5 crores. And agar mere paas already policies hain jo maine li hui hain pehle se, jinka total sum assured aa raha hai 3 crore. So today if I have a maximum eligibility of 5 crores and I hold policies of 3 crores, I can only take another few policies of 2 crores. I cannot exceed my maximum limit, which is why the past policies are also needed to be declared and considered.
How does it help?
Because like I said, see what happens is the insurance company calculates a human life value. So if some, let's take an example of a 20 year old and a 45 year old, and let's take retirement at the age of 60. So for a 45 year old person, the retirement age being 60, he has 15 more years to earn whatever income he can. Whereas a 20 year old person has 40 more years, you know. So the risk factor for both is completely different. And life insurance is based completely on the earned income of a person. So if I have 15 years of earning in time, like say I'm earning 10 lakhs a year and I have 15 years. So I have 15, what I can earn now is 15 lakh rupees in my earning years. Whereas a 20 year old earning 10 lakh rupees has 40 years. So he can earn in his entire working span, he can earn 40 lakhs. So he can take a policy up to 40 lakhs or a multiple of that, whereas I can only take a policy of 15 lakhs because I only have so much human value left in my life. So that will be considered by the insurance company.
Well, all these years,
mm-hmm.
I knew that human life cannot be quantified in terms of value.
Right.
Okay. It would be wrong to say
mm-hmm.
that my value is a crore of rupees.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
This is what I had learned
mm-hmm.
and having decades of experience in the industry.
Right.
This is what I knew and I am conquered with.
Mm-hmm.
So
mm-hmm.
I do not agree with your...
Sir, but there has to be some kind of a valid... explanation that we need also, right? Because for life insurance, how do you judge the value of a person then otherwise? How do you substantiate the fact that he can earn so much in his life and he cannot take a policy beyond that? Because what happens with life insurance again is that the insurable interest factor comes in, you know. If the insurance company allows me to take a policy far more than my worth as per their calculations, then there's a possibility that I might just kill myself and want to take that. Like, suppose I feel my family is in a lot of debt and
well, that happens. I understand. What you are trying to tell me is correct.
Yes.
What happens is that nowadays I have seen that people take multiple policies, term policy or endowment policy or some kind of policy from life insurance.
Right.
For several crores of rupees.
Right.
And gladly, the insurance company provides him or her the policies.
Right.
Although they do ask about how many policies and what quantum of that policy of sum assured you presently have. But despite the fact that suppose even if I am worth 1 crore, but I have a policy for 5 crores, they would be glad enough to give me the same.
So all of that is again mis-selling then, you know, that is not going correctly with the norms of the insurance company.
No mis-selling here, for simple reason that it's all documented on the proposal form.
Okay.
That I have a policy, I have this number of policies, totally 5 crores.
Right.
And the insurance company will not hesitate to give me a quotation that yes, for another crore rupees.
So if you have the eligibility, they can give you the policy. Otherwise, there is no way that they can give you the policy. The underwriting of the, they are very strict with their underwriting. I don't know aap kab ki baat kar rahe hain, but now they are very very strict with the underwriting. They will first evaluate the total eligibility of a person as per his age. So somebody who is the age of 35 and below, he can take 25 times his annual income or annual earned income. Somebody who is between 36 to 40 can take 20 times his annual income. 41 to 45 will be 15 times. You know, so there's this category.
There are slabs.
Yes, there are slabs. Mm-hmm. And whatever the total eligibility is, from that you will have to reduce whatever existing sum insured you have, and whatever is balance is the maximum they can give you then at that particular point of time. That is the criteria on how taking a sum insured or taking a new policy works, be it a term insurance or an endowment policy. They are slightly more lenient with endowment policy, savings plans, but with term insurance they are very 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 strict. Because endowment policies, you know there is a saving element, you are putting in the money, you are not going to withdraw, but term insurance is something that there can be a breach of insurable interest. If you are taking far more than what the human value they calculate, there can be definitely a breach of insurable interest in that. So, material facts, like we already discussed, the principle of utmost good faith holds true for all insurance policies, for all life insurance policies, where you have to declare all material facts which have a bearing on a person's life. So, what is the importance of principle of utmost good faith? It is to protect the interest of the community of policyholders and to ensure that the right premium is charged, to promote fairness among policyholders and ensure that no one gets undue advantage, and to ensure that new entrants are included in the appropriate risk class. So what happens is, even if one person misrepresents something and takes a policy. So suppose I am a smoker and I have not declared it, and certain parameters. So what happens is, medical test is not mandatory for all policies. The insurance company probably sees many other factors. If they feel it's required, if I'm like say of the age 25, I'm sum assured is not too high, and if all my whatever facts I've declared do not look like it's any kind of a risky proposal, you know, so they might not ask for a medical test from me. In such a case, me being a smoker, I have got the policy done, but however, I am not of standard life, but I have got the policy done in a non-smoker rate. So what happens is, that is a risk involved for all the others in the pool also, because I am a higher risk category, but I have put myself in a lower risk category. So if I happen to die early, everybody else is having to pay a higher premium, because premiums for everybody is charged based on what their claims come, you know, on a long term basis.
Yes.
So it is for fairness of everybody that everything be declared. I mean, a lot of people do not understand this, and कि मेरा प्रीमियम कम लग रहा है तब तक ठीक है वाली बात होती है, बट दूसरों के ऊपर भी इसका इम्पैक्ट आता है. अगर किसी ने मिसरिप्रेजेंट करके या झूठ बोल के या कुछ नहीं बता के पॉलिसी लेते हैं, तो दैट हैज अ बियरिंग ऑन एवरीबडी एल्स एज वेल. ऑफ कोर्स द फेयरनेस टू अदर पॉलिसी होल्डर्स एंड नोबडी गेट्स अनड्यू एडवांटेज इज व्हाट आई जस्ट सेड, एंड टू इंश्योर दैट द न्यू एंट्रेंट्स आर इंक्लूडेड इन द एप्रोप्रिएट रिस्क क्लास. अगेन सी, सो if I am substandard in my life, then I should be paying that extra premium so that everybody does not have to bear that burden of mine. And I am the one who is going to be bearing that burden. In case of death, then the insurance company has already taken a certain amount of premium from me where they are going to be covering my life for that. So again, who does the duty of disclosure lie on? It applies to both the proposal and the life to be insured. Where does it begin? At the time of proposal for insurance. Where does it end? At the time of commencement of risk. So once the risk has commenced, then that is where the duty of disclosure ends. So like say, for example, if the life to be insured falls sick, the fact that has to be informed to the insurance if it happens before the first premium receipt is insured, but not after. Like another example I can give you here is again smoker and non-smoker. Suppose while taking the policy I was a non-smoker, and 3 years down the line it's very much possible that a person starts smoking, you know. So then your risk category to bad gaya. But us time aap batate hain insurance company, to it's very good, but it is not mandatory that you tell them that I have now become a smoker. The insurance company is liable to pay the claim even after you have become a smoker, but we still tell everybody that it is always still better to declare if there is any kind of material change even after having taken the policy. But the duty of disclosure starts when you apply for a proposal, and it stops at the time when the risk has begun, when the policy is written and you have received your document. So it's the insurer's duty to voluntarily disclose the details of the insurance plan to the proposer or the life to be insured. So material facts that can affect the judgment of a prudent underwriter of an insurance company in deciding whether to insure a particular risk, the terms on which to insure it, and the premiums to be charged. So this is the voluntary disclosure by proposer or the life to be insured. So any detail that can for the underwriter to decide what kind of a risk is involved with this particular life, anything to do with that has to be disclosed. What is misrepresentation? Here is if we are substantially false and known by the proposer to be false. If there is something that is already known to me and I am probably not telling the insurance company, that will be called misrepresentation. Not known to the insurer. If sometimes what happens is that I have sent in my policy for a term insurance. Then they get and I at that point do not know I have diabetes. और बहुत बार होता है कि नहीं डिस्क्लोज होता है ना, आपको खुद को नहीं पता है कि है हमारे पास. फिर जब वो मेडिकल टेस्ट कराते हैं तो उसमें निकल के आता है. बट दैट विल स्टिल नॉट बी कॉल्ड मिसरिप्रेजेंटेशन बिकॉज मुझे पता नहीं था. बट लॉट ऑफ पीपल व्हाट हैपेंस इज दे ट्राई टेक अ चांस कि मुझे पता है मुझे डायबिटीज है, पर मैं नहीं बता रहा हूँ, मैं बोल रहा हूँ नहीं है मुझे डायबिटीज. अगर मैं वो करती हूँ तो वो मिसरिप्रेजेंटेशन हो जाता है.
तो इससे क्लेम में इफेक्ट आएगा?
जी जी जी, क्योंकि आई टेल यू कैसे आता है इसमें इफेक्ट. क्योंकि आपका जब कभी फ्यूचर में जाके सपोज हॉस्पिटलाइजेशन होता है तो आप डॉक्टर को तो आप झूठ नहीं बोलेंगे. डॉक्टर को तो आप बोलेंगे कि हाँ मुझे 2002 से मुझे डायबिटीज है, और यहाँ आपने पॉलिसी लिया 2011 में. तो जब और जब क्लेम आता है तो इंश्योरेंस कंपनी आपके सारे डॉक्यूमेंट्स को चेक कर सकती है, आपकी मेडिकल हिस्ट्री, आप हॉस्पिटल जाके वो पेपर्स निकलवा सकते हैं, सारा कुछ चेक कर सकते हैं. अगर उसमें निकल के आ गया उनके सामने कि आपको 2002 से डायबिटीज था, तो वो तो मिसरिप्रेजेंटेशन हो गया ना फिर आपका.
इसमें कई दफा ऐसा भी तो हो सकता है ना कि जैसे कि मैं अपने केस में बताता हूँ, कोई साल में एक बार जस्ट टेस्ट करवा लेता है. तो वो कई दफा होता है कि वो एक रैंडम टेस्ट होता है तो वो करवा लेगा कि इट्स ओके, पॉलिसी बाय कर ली. लेकिन बाय करने के बाद किसी कारण बस कुछ होता है, उस समय पता चलता है नहीं इसमें डायबिटीज था या
नहीं. तो उस टाइम तो नहीं था ना जब आपने पॉलिसी ली, तब नहीं था.
लेकिन मेरा कुछ प्रूफ तो नहीं है ना.
नहीं तो वो उससे कुछ फर्क नहीं पड़ता, क्योंकि जब आपको जब हुआ डिटेक्ट, जब नेक्स्ट आया सपोज एक साल बाद आया, तो आपका फर्स्ट डायग्नोसिस तो उस टाइम था ना. तो दैट इज द डेट इज आफ्टर द आफ्टर टेकिंग द पॉलिसी. तो उस टाइम जब आपने पॉलिसी ली तब नहीं था बोल के आपके, अगर आपके पास कोई प्रूफ नहीं भी है, पर आपका फर्स्ट डेट ऑफ डायग्नोसिस तो आपका एक साल के बाद का था, तो दैट इटसेल्फ इज प्रूफ इनफ. उसमें फिर कोई प्रॉब्लम नहीं आती है. बिकॉज
उससे इसका
अगर ये प्रूव हो जाता है ना कि आपका उस पॉलिसी आपने 2011 में लिया, उसके 4 साल पहले से आपको डायबिटीज था, कोई भी आपके प्रिस्क्रिप्शन में निकल के आ जाता है, डॉक्टर्स के या रिपोर्ट्स आ जाते हैं, हॉस्पिटलाइजेशन के फैक्ट्स में आ जाता है, कुछ आ जाता है, तब उसमें प्रॉब्लम होती है. पर आपका डेट ऑफ डायग्नोसिस इज आफ्टर द डेट ऑफ पॉलिसी, तब कोई प्रॉब्लम नहीं आती. सो नाउ नॉन डिस्क्लोजर होता है कि इंश्योर डज नॉट डिस्क्लोज इन्फॉर्मेशन अबाउट मटेरियल फैक्ट बिकॉज द इंश्योरर हैज नॉट रेज्ड एनी स्पेसिफिक इंक्वायरी. तो इनकेस इंश्योरर अगर आपसे स्पेसिफिकली कुछ क्वेश्चन नहीं पूछता और आप नहीं बताते हैं तो दैट बिकम्स नॉन डिस्क्लोजर. व्हेन अ फैक्ट इज इंटेंशनली सप्रेस्ड इट इज नोन एज कंसीलमेंट. कि आप जानते हुए अगर नॉन डिस्क्लोजर होता है कि इंश्योरर ने मुझसे पूछा ही नहीं तो मैंने बताया नहीं, आपने मुझसे पूछा ही नहीं तो मैं कैसे बताती. कंसीलमेंट होता है कि आपको पता है, आपसे पूछा गया है, पर आप उसको छुपा रहे हैं और आपने बताया नहीं. दैट विल बी कॉल्ड एज कंसीलमेंट. सो बोथ इनफैक्ट विल कम अंडर मिसरेप्रेजेंटेशन एंड इट इज समथिंग दैट वी ट्राई एंड अवॉइड एट ऑल कॉस्ट. लाइक से कंसीलमेंट वुड बी हैबिट्स. अगर आप एक कोई है कि बहुत अल्कोहल जैसी चीज है जो आपके प्रोबेबली ब्लड टेस्ट में 24 घंटे के बाद नहीं आएगी, यू नो, एंड अगर कोई मेजरली अल्कोहलिक है और 4 दिन तक उसने नहीं ड्रिंक किया क्योंकि उसको पॉलिसी लेना था, फिर उसने ब्लड टेस्ट करा दी, उसमें तो आएगा नहीं. बट फ्यूचर में जाके वो फिर से उसका उसने स्टार्ट कर दिया ड्रिंकिंग बहुत, पर फिर ये जाके कहीं पे एस्टैब्लिश हो गया कि पॉलिसी लेने के पहले ही अल्कोहलिक था, तब उसमें प्रॉब्लम आ सकती है.
लेकिन वो रेगुलर नहीं है, ओकेजनली है,
हाँ दैट इज ओके, ओकेजनल है, आपके विद इन लिमिट्स है, उसमें कोई इंश्योरेंस कंपनी को प्रॉब्लम नहीं है. कभी अल्कोहलिक लिमिट तक चला जाता है दैट इज अ प्रॉब्लम फॉर द इंश्योरेंस कंपनी.
सिगरेट तो कॉमन है उसमें तो.
सिगरेट के लिए दे विल आस्क यू वेदर यू आर अ स्मोकर और नॉन स्मोकर.
मेडिकल जो मेडिकल ट्रिगर हो गया था, बट व्हाट हैपेंड एचडीएफसी ने क्या कहा कि भाई ठीक है वी विल हैव अ एक मतलब वो लोग बॉम्बे से कॉल करेंगे एंड दे आस्क मी व्हेदर आई ड्रिंक और नॉट. आई सेड ओकेशनली बट आई एम अ स्मोकर बाय हैबिट.
ओके,
बट हमको स्मोकिंग के बारे में पूछा नहीं.
अच्छा,
एंड जब पूछा नहीं तो मैंने कहा नहीं.
राइट,
तो डज इट टेंटामाउंट टू सप्रेशन ऑफ मटेरियल फैक्ट. डिस्कशन जो हुआ है जिस रिकॉर्डेड है, मतलब उन्होंने रिकॉर्ड किया था, तो उसमें उसने स्मोकिंग के बारे में नहीं पूछा था मुझसे.
इट विल बी कंसीडर्ड मिसरेप्रेजेंटेशन टू अ सर्टेन एक्सटेंट बिकॉज़ इट डज हैव अ बेयरिंग ऑन योर लाइफ. नाउ अगेन इट कैन गो अब कभी जब अगर कंटेंशन में आता है बिकॉज़ क्योंकि हेल्थ इंश्योरेंस में भी आपका अगर स्मोकिंग एंड ड्रिंकिंग है दे माइट गिव यू अ लोडिंग ऑन योर प्रीमियम. सो स्मोकिंग के लिए अलग होता है और ड्रिंकिंग के लिए अलग होता है. तो अगर आपने स्मोकिंग डिक्लेयर नहीं किया है इट कुड कॉज अ प्रॉब्लम एट अ लेटर पॉइंट ऑफ टाइम. It is always best to let them know and pay the loading amount and so that आपके claim के see what happens is the premium, the extra premium that loading.
Sorry madam, HDFC मेरा जो primary policy है, वे भी मतलब health insurance का, that is also with HDFC.
Okay.
For last 10 years, not a single penny I claimed.
Okay.
I'm getting full no claim bonus, cumulative bonus. ठीक है. अब मैंने सोचा कि because जो हेल्थ इंश्योरेंस जो है आई थिंक आई नीड फॉर अ हायर अमाउंट, इसलिए कि कोरोना है तो ये है तो जीका है, तो मैंने सोचा था कि इसको हेल्थ बढ़ा लेते हैं. तो प्राइमरी पॉलिसी में बढ़ाने से क्या है कि यू पे अ लॉट सिग्निफिकेंट लॉट ऑफ प्रीमियम, टॉप अप लेने में कम लगता है. इसीलिए मैंने टॉप अप ले लिया था. टॉप अप में जो हमारे पास क्वेश्चन आया था इन द फॉर्म ऑफ एक्सेल फाइल, तो उसमें जहाँ जहाँ फिलअप करना था मैंने फिलअप कर करके दे दिया. दे सेड दैट ठीक है आप लोग का आपके साथ हम टेलीफोनिक ये करेंगे. और उसने मुझे ड्रिंकिंग जो है मैंने कहा मैं ड्रिंक नहीं करता हूँ ओकेशनली, मैंने ये कहा था. स्मोकिंग के बारे में मैंने पूछा तो मैंने बताया नहीं उसे. रही है आई डोंट नो वेदर दिस इज गोइंग टू have a bearing on my claim.
It could. What we can do is probably, you know, check with somebody in the health insurance department here because I'm not an expert in health insurance. So they will be able to, you know, tell you exactly कि अब आपको declare करना चाहिए कि नहीं करना चाहिए उस चीज़ को. सूरजीत है हमारी company में या फिर विशाल, तो उनसे एक बार discuss करने से I think they'll be able to give you a clear picture. So, ये मैंने आपको पहले भी बताया. Section 45 stipulates that a life insurance policy cannot be called in question on any ground after 3 years from the date of issuance of the policy or the date of the revival of the policy, whichever is later. तो जितने भी मटेरियल फैक्ट्स जो भी है वंस द पॉलिसी इज इशूड और 3 साल निकल जाते हैं अगर, तो इंश्योरेंस कंपनी के नॉट कॉल ऑन इट फॉर एनी मिसरिप्रेजेंटेशन और एनी फैक्ट्स और एनीथिंग. अगर 3 साल निकल गए हैं तो इंश्योरेंस कंपनी के पास कोई ग्राउंड नहीं है उसको कोई भी क्वेश्चन उसके ऊपर रेज करने के लिए. नाउ वी कम टू इंश्योरेबल इंटरेस्ट. सो what is insurable interest and what are the types of insurable interest. See now, speculative, there are 2 types of risks, speculative risk and non-speculative risks. Speculative risks are where we know for a sure that there is either going to be a gain or a loss. जैसे आप stock market में invest करते हैं, you know for sure कि या तो आपको gain होगा या आपको loss होगा, ठीक है. Non-speculative risk क्या हुआ, जहाँ पे आपको पता नहीं है कि risk loss हो सकता है आपका, like taking your car out on the road. आप जब निकाल रहे हैं आपको ये नहीं पता कि एक्सीडेंट होगा कि नहीं होगा, हो सकता है पर आपको पता नहीं है कि होगा. वेरेस आप जैसे हॉर्स राइडिंग में अगर आप डर्बी में आप पैसे लगा रहे हैं तो आपको पता है या तो आप गेन करेंगे या आप लूज करेंगे. सो दैट बिकम्स अ स्पेक्युलेटिव रिस्क एंड इंश्योरेंस बिकम्स नॉन स्पेक्युलेटिव रिस्क. सो द स्पेक्युलेटिव रिस्क इज नॉट इंश्योरेबल, यू कैन नॉट इंश्योर दैट. ओनली रिस्क विच इज नॉन स्पेक्युलेटिव इन नेचर इज वॉट वी कैन इंश्योर. So some examples are horse racing, lottery, movement in stock market. These are all speculative risks. Whereas non-speculative risks would be life insurance contracts, marine insurance contracts, and fire insurance contracts. So marine insurance contracts. Now, what is the if a ship is going with my goods in it? So do I have insurable interest? Of course I have insurable interest क्योंकि उसमें मेरे गुड्स जा रहे हैं. पर अगर आपके गुड्स जा रहे हैं किसी शिप में तो उससे मेरा क्या लेना देना, उसमें मेरा कोई रिस्क इन्वॉल्व नहीं है तो मेरा कोई इंश्योरेबल इंटरेस्ट नहीं हुआ. बट आपके गुड्स हैं अगर तो आपका इंश्योरेबल इंटरेस्ट हुआ. सो दिस प्रिंसिपल वर्क्स फॉर इंश्योरेंस बोथ इन नॉन लाइफ एज वेल एज लाइफ इंश्योरेंस. सो द प्रपोजर मस्ट हैव अ स्टेक इन द कंटिन्यूएंस ऑफ द सब्जेक्ट मैटर इंश्योर्ड एंड कुड सफर अ लॉस इफ द रिस्क अकर्स. In the case of life insurance, insurable interest should exist at the start of the insurance policy. Insurable interest need not be present at the time of renewal premium or claim. एक बार insurance मतलब जब policy जब आपके issuance में जाती है, जब proposal stage में होता है, तभी वो check किया जाता है कि insurable interest है कि नहीं है. अब जैसे in life insurance, आज मैं अपने बच्चे के लिए एक life insurance policy देती हूँ, तो वो valid contract होगा क्योंकि उसमें insurable interest है. मेरे नहीं रहने से मेरे बच्चे के ऊपर impact आएगा. बट अगर मैं अब थर्ड मेरे नेबर के, मैं अपने नेबर के लिए तो लाइफ इंश्योरेंस पॉलिसी नहीं ले सकती क्योंकि उसके नहीं रहने से मेरे ऊपर कोई इम्पैक्ट नहीं आएगा. सो जहां पे किसी का कोई रिलेशन है तब आप इंश्योरेबल लाइफ इंश्योरेंस हाँ ले सकते हैं, इंश्योरेबल इंटरेस्ट बनता है. अगर नहीं है तो वो आप पॉलिसी नहीं ले सकते.
मींस अगर कोई चाहे अपने सर्वेंट के लिए लेना तो वो भी नहीं ले सकते.
किसी तरह से आपका इंश्योरेबल इंटरेस्ट प्रूव होना चाहिए. जैसे एक एम्प्लॉयर एम्प्लॉय में ले सकते हैं क्योंकि एम्प्लॉयर अगर लेता है एम्प्लॉय के नाम पे पॉलिसी तो देयर इज अ पॉसिबिलिटी कि इस पर्टिकुलर एम्प्लॉय के नहीं रहने से आपकी कंपनी में सफर कर सकता है, कुछ लॉसेस हो सकते हैं, तो वो आपका की मैन इंश्योरेंस जिसको कहते हैं हम, वो आप ले सकते हैं. हो सकता है वो उसको एज अ परक्विजिट देना चाहते हो तो वो इंश्योरेबल इंटरेस्ट हो जाता है, यू नो. सो इट हैज टू बी प्रूव. क्रेडिटर डेटर है उसमें भी आपका इंश्योरेबल इंटरेस्ट होता है कि अगर वो नॉन पेमेंट होता है अगर उनका तो फिर उसमें रिस्क इन्वॉल्व है. सो देयर हैज टू बी सम काइंड ऑफ इंश्योरेबल इंटरेस्ट व्हिच हैज टू बी एस्टैब्लिश्ड, ओनली देन अ इंश्योरेंस कॉन्ट्रैक्ट कैन बी वैलिड. द एग्जिस्टेंस ऑफ इंश्योरेबल इंटरेस्ट इज डिसाइडेड बाय द इंटरेस्ट व्हिच द प्रपोजर हैज इन द एसेट्स बीइंग इंश्योर्ड, द रिलेशनशिप बिटवीन द प्रपोजर एंड द ऑब्जेक्ट ऑफ इंश्योरेंस एंड द लीगल डिसीजंस ऑन दीस मैटर्स. सो दिस प्रीटी मच वी हैव डिस्कस्ड. Now, what are wager contracts and what are insurance contracts? Wager contracts will be speculative in nature and insurance contracts are non-speculative. Wager contracts mein there is no insurable interest in the subject matter, whereas in insurance contracts there is insurable interest. In wager contracts, the party could have avoided the loss, whereas in insurance contracts, the party could not have avoided the loss. In wager contracts are illegal and insurance contracts are legal. Now, Let's take an example of somebody's mother's necklace. So, हो सकता है कि value of that particular necklace is probably 10 lakhs. But because it has passed down 5 generations, that meri emotional value uske 10 lakhs ki jagah 20 lakhs hai, can I insure it at 20 lakhs? Nahi, aap wo nahi kar sakte. Aapko uski value, aap emotional value ko nahi kar sakte, aap uske jo actual value hai aap usi ko insure kar sakte. Ab insure, ab human life mein aap ek husband wife hai, to husband wife ke liye important hai uske life mein us nahi rehne se us, there is going to be a bearing in her life, which is why it can be insurable. So the basic criteria for insurance is existing of insurable interest. Insurable interest is not defined or written in any law. What that means is कि हर बार आपका case to case basis पे उसको judge किया जाता है. There are of course certain जो है कि आप husband wife के नाम पे ले सकता है या wife husband के नाम पे ले सकती है, मैं अपने बच्चों के लिए ले सकती हूँ. But there are times where insurable interest है कि नहीं है, वो it is, there is no written book or law कि ये ही insurable interest है. It will be decided case to case basis. Court judgments have explained that circumstances where insurable interest deemed to exist. So कभी कभी होता है कि फिर वो अगर law में जाता है तो court ही decide करता है कि insurable interest था कि नहीं था. So these are some examples जहाँ पे insurable interest है कि self, अगर मैं अपने ही life में कोई policy लेती हूँ, husband, between husband and wife, parents and children, employer, employee, creditor, debtor, partners. So all these are examples of insurable interest. Okay, so we now come to indemnity. So what do we understand by the word indemnity? If you all have any idea what indemnity
is? Indemnity is something which the insurer pays.
Yes.
When there is a loss.
Right. Okay. So what that exactly means is the insurer pays the loss to the extent of the loss occurred.
Exactly.
Yes. So I might have a policy for 10 lakhs, but suppose I got hospitalized and my bills were only for 2 lakhs. So the insurer is only going to pay me 2 lakhs. He's not going to pay me 10 lakhs because my policy was right. for 10 lakhs.
Right.
Indemnity is, yes, making good what has been lost. Mm-hmm. That exactly is what indemnity means. Okay. So that is something that is applicable to non-life insurance, to general insurance. It is not applicable to life insurance. Life insurance contracts are always benefit contracts. Mm-hmm. It is not indemnity. Benefit contract means whatever the sum assured is the amount that is going to be payable. Claim cannot, so indemnity means claim cannot exceed the amount of loss incurred. So claim has to be equal to or lesser than the loss incurred, which is not applicable to life insurance. Insurance, this again means insurance, indemnity means that insurance should place the insurer in the same financial position after the loss as he enjoyed it before it, not better. It cannot be that the insurance company pays you more than the loss that you have incurred. Okay, so this is an example of indemnity again. Here the policy or the car value and the policy value is 4 lakhs, but the loss is 25,000. So of course the claim is going to be for 25,000 and not for 4 lakhs. So insurance is here putting the insured in the same financial position as they were in before and not better than what they were at start. So principle of indemnity here, insurance is meant to compensate the losses. In the above scenario, the insurance company compensates Rahul's losses. The claim amount cannot exceed the amount of loss. The insurance company paid Rahul the amount equivalent to cover the cost of repairs of his cars. So insurance cannot be used for making a profit. And principle of indemnity does not apply to life insurance. This we will just understand a little more in detail. So what are the advantages of life insurance?
Principle indemnity is not applied for life insurance.
Yes.
लेकिन वो भी तो उसका पार्ट है, लाइक पार्शियली डिसेबलमेंट.
नहीं तो अगेन सी उसमें क्या होता है कि इस लाइफ इंश्योरेंस में क्या होता है, बेनिफिट, इसको कहते हैं बेनिफिट प्लान. बेनिफिट प्लान का क्या मतलब होता है, इसमें एक सम अश्योर्ड होता है अगेंस्ट एवरीथिंग. आप जो डिसेबिलिटी की भी बोल रहे हैं उसका भी एक सम अश्योर्ड होता है. जब हम पॉलिसी, व्हेन वी स्टार्ट द पॉलिसी, देयर इज अ सम अश्योर्ड, देयर इज अ लाइफ कवर जिसका एक सम अश्योर्ड है. अगर डिसेबिलिटी राइडर दिया हुआ मेरा उसका एक सम अश्योर्ड है.
वो तो इनबिल्ट था ना. नहीं,
not necessary, not all plans have inbuilt disability riders. किसी में होता है, किसी में नहीं होता है. आप उसको add on ले सकते हैं. किसी में inbuilt है तो आपको automatically मिलेगा. जिस जो भी है उसका एक sum assured रहेगा. अगर आपने critical illness rider ले रखा उसका एक sum assured है. तो whenever that particular condition is met, चाहे वो disability है, चाहे वो critical illness है, जो भी है, तो जो sum assured है, that total amount will be paid to you. इट इज नॉट कि उसमें से लाइक सपोज डिसेबिलिटी हो गई किसी को, मेरा मेरे पॉलिसी में डिसेबिलिटी के लिए मैंने राइडर ले रखा था 10 लाख रुपए, ठीक है, और अब मुझे डिसेबिलिटी हो गई है तो मैं फॉर व्हाटएवर रीजन मुझे हॉस्पिटल जाना पड़ा, वहां मेरा बिल 2 लाख आया, तो ये नहीं है कि इंश्योरेंस कंपनी मुझे 2 लाख देगी। अगर दैट पर्टिकुलर कंडीशन वॉज मेट और मेरा सम अश्योर्ड 10 लाख था, वो मुझे 10 लाख दे देगी। हाउ आई स्पेंड इट इज अप टू मी, इट डज नॉट, इंश्योरेंस कंपनी इज नॉट बॉदर्ड विद हाउ यू आर स्पेंडिंग इट।
डिसेबिलिटी मीन्स कि कोई पॉलिसी अगर ले रहा है तो उसमें अगर आपका लाइक एक हाथ एक
पैर चला गया,
या उसके लिए एक परसेंटेज है, थंब अगर चला गया, हैंड और लेग व्हाटएवर, तो उसके लिए एक सर्टेन एक्स अमाउंट है, तो वो तो इंडेमनिटी में के सब में मैच
इंडेमनिटी नहीं हुआ ना, मेरा जो सम अश्योर्ड है
उसका एक्स परसेंटेज
वो मुझे लमसम में मिल जाएगा।
अच्छा, वो डिसाइड किया हुआ,
हां वो ऑलरेडी प्री डिसाइडेड है,
प्री डिसाइडेड
कि मेरा सम अश्योर्ड प्री डिसाइडेड है व्हेन आई एम टेकिंग द पॉलिसी। सपोज मैंने चाहे 10 लाख लिया हो चाहे 15 लाख लिया हो जो भी लिया,
और ये यहां जो है वो कि आपका
हॉस्पिटलाइजेशन हुआ आपका, वहां पे आपका 10 लाख की पॉलिसी थी पर आपका ट्रीटमेंट कॉस्ट 2 लाख आया, तो आपको 2 लाख ही मिलेंगे, आपको 10 लाख नहीं मिलेंगे। So that is the basic difference between indemnity policies and benefit policies. So life insurance policies are always benefit policies. So what are the advantages of taking a life insurance policy? It protects targeted savings. It creates an immediate asset, encourages long-term savings, provides protection against creditors, provides tax relief. So of course, you know what happens with life insurance policies is that you are paying a premium every year. And these are long-term contracts. We generally you know tell clients also and everybody ki chote period ke liye life insurance mat lijiye, it does not solve a purpose kyunki aapki life cover bhi thodi rehti hai aur aapko returns jo agar aapki benefit plan hai, agar aapke savings plan hai to usme aapko benefit bhi zyada nahi milega, agar 10 saal ki policy hai 5 saal ki policy hai to usme koi zyada benefit nahi aata hai, kareeb at least 20 years ki policy agar aap lete hain to aap ek chota chota amount har saal pay kar rahe hain to wo aapke liye ek saving ho jati hai। At the end time of maturity, जब एक वो पूरा लमसम अमाउंट आता है तो एक substantial अमाउंट आता है, so it helps in targeted savings every year, creates an immediate asset, of course it's an asset that you're creating for yourself, encourages long term savings, yes, तो वो ये कि थोड़ा थोड़ा करके आपने जमा कर लिया, आपको एक time पे जाके आपको लमसम अमाउंट मिल जाता है, provides protection against creditors, अब जैसे अगर किसी ने term insurance लिया, उसने home loan भी ले रखा था साथ में, कोई कारण से अगर डेथ हो गई अर्ली तो फाइनल फैमिली के ऊपर कितना बड़ा बर्डन आ जाता है उसमें, तो कम से कम अगर टर्म इंश्योरेंस दिया था उसमें से मुझे एक बहुत अच्छा खासा पैसा मिल जाएगा, तो इट्स पॉसिबल दैट आई कैन पे ऑफ माई क्रेडिटर्स फ्रॉम दैट। प्रोवाइड टैक्स रिलीफ, लाइफ इंश्योरेंस पॉलिसीज आप जो प्रीमियम दैट यू पे इज टैक्स फ्री अंडर सेक्शन 80C एंड द बेनिफिट्स यू रिसीव्ड अंडर इज अगेन टैक्स फ्री अंडर सेक्शन 1010D। So you're getting tax benefits on both ends, on the premiums you pay and the maturity benefit. But however, life insurance also has some limitations that all risks cannot be insured. Like we had discussed earlier, कि अगर enough takers हैं कोई particular risk के लिए, only then insurance companies write that kind of a policy. All risks are not covered. You know, आज में अगर एक like there used to be some policies for disabled children and कभी कभी आ जाती है, but in general disabled के लिए कम policies बनती है, you know, आज कोई कहता है कि मुझे अपनी eyesight को, you know, support, there are people जिनका profession ये है कि उनके आँख से related है या hearing से है या tasting से है, तो वो कहेंगे कि मुझे अपनी आँखों को insure करना है, या मेरी like लता मंगेशकर, she probably wants to insure her voice box, वो उन्होंने तो किया हुआ भी है, तो इंश्योरेंस इंडस्ट्री हैज टू सी कि हाँ वो उनके लिए वायबल पॉलिसी है भी कि नहीं है, यू नो, सो कोई रैंडम कोई भी रिक्वेस्ट नहीं किया जाएगा कि मुझे ये इंश्योर करना है, नॉट नेसेसरी, इट कैन बी इंश्योर्ड, इंश्योरेबल इंटरेस्ट मस्ट एग्जिस्ट। तो आज मैं अगर एज अ गिफ्ट किसी के लिए लेना चाहूँ, आई कैन नॉट टेक इट, क्योंकि वो इंश्योरेबल इंटरेस्ट नहीं रहेगा, आज मैं अपनी फ्रेंड को एक इंश्योरेंस पॉलिसी देना चाहती हूँ गिफ्ट, दैट विल नॉट वर्क बिकॉज देयर इज नो इंश्योरेबल इंटरेस्ट। लॉ ऑफ लार्ज नंबर शुड प्रिवेल, अगेन इफ देयर आर टू लेस नंबर ऑफ पीपल वांटिंग अ सिमिलर काइंड ऑफ पॉलिसी, नहीं होगा, बहुत ज्यादा लार्ज नंबर होगा तब इंश्योरेंस कंपनी के लिए दैट इज अ वायबल प्रपोजल। लॉसेस मस्ट अराइज ड्यू टू अनसर्टेन इवेंट्स, स्पेक्युलेटिव रिस्क को कवर नहीं करता है, इसलिए नॉन स्पेक्युलेटिव अगर है इन नेचर ओनली देन इट कैन गेट कवर्ड। इट मस्ट बी कंसिस्टेंट विद पब्लिक पॉलिसी, इसमें आपका इट हैज टू बी पास बाय IRDA, दे हैव टू हैव इट अप्रूव्ड इट एज अ गवर्निंग बॉडी, एंड वो पब्लिकली आपका कंसिस्टेंट होता है तभी आप उसको अंडर राइट कर सकते हैं। Now we come to types of products. So insurance ke do branches we know, there is life insurance and there is general insurance. Here we are obviously talking about life insurance. There are conventional plans and there are unit linked plans. So unit linked plans, let's talk about the conventional plans first. Conventional plans are the traditional plans. So there is two basic elements in that. There is the death benefit and there is survival benefit. या पैसे कब मिलते हैं, या तो डेथ होने पे मिलते हैं या फिर सर्वाइवल होने पे. सर्वाइवल आपकी पॉलिसी पीरियड को आप सर्वाइव कर जाते हैं तब आपको पैसे मिलते हैं. ऑन मैच्योरिटी, यस. सो देयर इज द डेथ कवर व्हिच इज पार्ट ऑफ इट, द सम अश्योर्ड व्हिच इज पेबल ऑन डेथ, एंड ऑन द सम अश्योर्ड व्हिच इज पेड ऑन सर्वाइवल ऑफ द पर्सन, व्हिच इज अगेन कंप्लीटली प्योर एंडाउमेंट, मतलब यू आर गेटिंग एंडाउड बाय दैट पर्टिकुलर अमाउंट. सो कन्वेंशनल प्लान्स का फीचर्स क्या होता है, दे आर पार्शली गारंटीड in the form of sum assured and attached bonuses. So generally what happens with traditional plans is they have a sum assured, which is the life cover of a person, plus every year some kind of a bonus gets attached to it. Bonus is declared by the insurance company every year and it forms a part of that policy. Of course it's not payable on a yearly basis, it is payable on maturity only, but every year it forms part of the policy. So one guaranteed part is the sum assured, and bonus every year whatever is declared by the company will get attached to the policy. Non-guaranteed benefits in the form of bonuses to be declared in the future. Premium payment differs according to age, term, mode, etc. So a person who takes a life insurance policy early, say 20 years versus 55, 20 years wale ko comparatively much lower premium pay karna padega versus somebody who is 55 years of age. No flexibility in premium payment and risk cover offered. So of course you know payment, premium payment ek bar jo fix ho jata hai wo fix ho jata hai life insurance mein at the time whenever you have taken it. Guaranteed sum assured on maturity. So there are some plans which give you the sum assured, anyways is always guaranteed in all life insurance policies. Bonus is the variable aspect. Bonus as per the declared by the company will get attached to the policy and will become part of the policy. What are the types of conventional plans? There is term insurance, there's whole life assurance, endowment assurance and annuities. So these are the basic four types of plans that we have.
Endowment or annuities? What is?
Annuities. We'll come to that. Let's just go one by one. So term assurance is where for a specific period of time a person takes a policy and your life is covered for that particular policy. This is what we call the term insurance, which is the most common and the most probably say essential kind of life insurance at the moment. It has really gained popularity in the last 10 years where people do understand the need for a term insurance and the financial protection that you can get at a much lower premium than your savings and endowment plans. So isme kya hota hai that it covers death for a fixed period of time, for say, and this policy, the period can be quite large. So you can get covered right up till the age of 85 or even till the age of 100. Ki between that period, if death happens, the jitna sum assured aapka liya hua will be paid to the nominee. Nominee generally is of course your wife or your children, whatever. So it is for essentially for protection of your family. Kyunki jo insured person hai, uske jeete jee kuch paise nahi mil rahe, uske death hoti hai, to family ko wo paise milte hai. So it is not for your benefit, it is for the benefit of your family. Okay, so that they are able to sustain similar lifestyle what they were living while you were alive, you know, while the insured person was alive. The life insured is not paid anything if he survives till the end of the term of the policy. So another feature of this is ki agar suppose maine 85 tak ke liye coverage liya hua hai, aaj main 40 saal ki hu, my policy is for a period of 45 years and I fortunately do not die by the age of 85 and I die in the 86th year, when I turn 86. In such a scenario, no payment is made to the insured or the nominee because policy aapki khatam ho chuki hai, expired ho chuki hai. However, there are plans with return of premium and you know they have some kind of income aspect built in and all. Wo alag alag type ki plans hain. That option is available nowadays in term insurance. Bahut changes aa chuke hain term insurance mein. बट इसेंशियली क्या होता है कि एक वनीला टर्म प्लान जो हम लेते हैं उसमें आपकी पॉलिसी पीरियड तक आपका कवर रहता है, अगर आप उसको सर्वाइव करते हैं तो आपको कुछ पे ऑफ नहीं मिलता है. जैसे मैंने इसका बता दिया. ओके, सो नाउ वी कम टू होल लाइफ अश्योरेंस. होल लाइफ अश्योरेंस एज द नेम इटसेल्फ सजेस्ट कि ये आपके पूरे होल लाइफ के लिए चलती है. it's valid throughout the year, throughout your a person's lifespan. So it has a summation.
Yes, Titi. वो जो last slide जो था, उसमें जो क्या थे? Permission. इसमें जो like वो 85 तक या 75 age तक जो लेता है, उसको क्या premium once in policy timing period का एक साथ में देना पड़ता है और he'll pay.
No, there are various way you can pay premiums. Either आप एक साथ में भी दे सकते हैं in one single shot. आप 5 साल तक भी दे सकते हैं, 5 consecutive years तक आप दीजिए. उसके बाद आपको premium payment नहीं करना है, but your policy will continue. You can take that as a 10-year term also, 12 years. You can even pay up till the age of 60. So suppose if I'm 45 years of age today, I want to take the premium payment term as pay till the age of 60. So मैं 15 साल pay करूँगी, उसके बाद मुझे और payment नहीं करना है, but my policy will continue till the age of 85.
अच्छा जी.
हाँ, regular भी आप ले सकते हैं. Of course, premium कितना आप pay करें will depend on the term that you take, payment term that you're taking. You know, 5 साल में of course I will have to pay a much larger amount than if I take a regular premium paying term. रेगुलर में मैं हर साल दे रही हूँ, तो 5 साल में सबसे ज्यादा देना होगा, सिंगल प्रीमियम में सबसे ज्यादा देना होगा, फिर 5 साल, फिर 10 साल, 12 साल, ऐसा. सो हियर होल लाइफ में क्या होता है कि द पॉलिसी रन्स फॉर देयर एंटायर लाइफ स्पैन ऑफ द पर्सन. सो देयर आर, आई डोंट नो इफ यू हर्ड ऑफ जीवन आनंद. सो व्हाट हैपेंस इज, अगर आपने जीवन आनंद 20 साल का प्रीमियम पेमेंट टर्म लिया है, तो उसमें आपके 20 साल जब आप प्रीमियम खत्म कर देते हैं, 21वें साल में आपको सम अशर्ड प्लस बोनसेस एक बार मिल जाता है. देन योर पॉलिसी कीप्स रनिंग फॉर योर एंटायर लाइफ. जब भी डेथ होगी, नॉमिनी विल गेट द सम अशर्ड अगेन. सो सच काइंड ऑफ प्लान्स रन फॉर द एंटायर टाइम फ्रेम एंड ऑफ द लाइफ स्पैन ऑफ द पर्सन टिल डेथ.
इसमें ऐसा कुछ नहीं, कोई इंश्योरेंस कंपनी बोल दे नहीं आपकी इसका जो प्लान उस टाइम पे सर्टेन टाइम पे चल रहा था, लेकिन ये आफ्टर 5 इयर्स ये प्लान चेंज हो गया.
नहीं, वो नहीं चेंज कर सकते. इंश्योरेंस कंपनी अगर विड्रॉ भी करती है कोई पर्टिकुलर प्लान, तो आपकी अगर राइट विल बी वो पॉलिसी, दे विल हैव टू कीप गिविंग यू दोस बेनिफिट्स.
पॉलिसी ऑलरेडी मेंशन इन पॉलिसी वर्डिंग.
यस यस,
दैट काइंड ऑफ.
यस, सो बिकॉज इट इज ऑल गवर्नड बाय IRDA, देयर इज एवरी पॉसिबिलिटी कि किसी इंश्योरेंस कंपनी ने प्लान इंट्रोड्यूस किया है, 4 साल तक उसको रखा है, उस बीच में मैंने ले ली पॉलिसी, उसके बाद उन्होंने विड्रॉ कर लिया. पर मेरे लिए जब वो कॉन्ट्रैक्ट लिख चुका है, तो वो उसमें जो है वो मुझे मिलेगा, उसके बेनिफिट मुझे मिलेंगे. दे कैन नॉट चेंज इट मिडवे कि अब वो पॉलिसी हट गई है तो आपके बेनिफिट भी नहीं मिलेंगे, ऐसे नहीं कर सकते. दैट हैज टू बी पेड. सो कॉन्ट्रैक्ट इज फॉर द होल लाइफ एंड एंड्स विद द डेथ ऑफ द पर्सन. लॉन्ग टर्म लाइफ इंश्योरेंस कॉन्ट्रैक्ट, टर्म इंश्योरेंस प्लान्स एक्सटेंड टिल सर्वाइवल ऑफ द पर्सन. दिस आई हैव ऑलरेडी एक्सप्लेन. Features of whole life assurance will be policy continues till the death and this plan is suitable for those who want to leave an estate for the children. Of course, you know, because on my death, if my family is going to get a certain amount of money, it is for people who want to leave. Like मेरे जीते जी कुछ amount मिल गया, पर मेरे मरने के बाद मेरी family को कुछ मिलेगा. So it's good for those such kind of people. Now we come to endowment policies. In such policies, they are for a fixed period of term. Say 20 years, 15 years, 25 years, whatever the term must be, but they don't run for the whole life, but they run for a certain period of time. So, sum assured is also for a fixed amount. The payment of sum assured will be on survival till the end of the term or earlier. So, suppose my policy is for 20 years. तो 20 years या तो खत्म हो जाएंगे तब मुझे पैसे मिलेंगे, या within those 20 years अगर मेरी death हो जाती तो nominee को मेरे पैसे मिल जाते. अगर मैं सर्वाइव कर जाती हूँ तो मुझे पैसे मिल जाएंगे फिर एट द एंड ऑफ द टर्म.
ये कैलेंडर
नहीं, ये तो ये क्या कहते हैं,
ईयर
ईयर के हिसाब से उन्होंने ये किस लिए दे दिया है. इसके एक सेकंड, इसके बाद कुछ नहीं. टर्म ऑफ द पॉलिसी, बट वो ही कह रहे हैं कि अगर ये मेरे जितने टर्म के लिए ली है, ऑन डेथ और सर्वाइवल व्हाटएवर वी विल गेट. So, endowment policies में of course the composition is term assurance plus plus pure endowment, कि एक certain life cover तो रहता ही है, उसके बाद में savings element जो रहता है. So in such plans what happens is जो हम premium pay करते हैं, insurance company उसमें से एक certain amount mortality के लिए काटती है, बाकी पैसे को invest करती है. तो life cover के लिए जो amount है वो mortality rate मेरा कटता है, बाकी जो है वो सेविंग्स एलिमेंट है जो कि मेरा हाउएवर दे व्हिचएवर पोर्टफोलियो दे इन्वेस्ट इन वो इन्वेस्ट करती है, एंड एट द एंड ऑफ द मैच्योरिटी टर्म वो मुझे उसके हिसाब से वो पैसे मिल जाते हैं. बेनिफिट इज डेथ बेनिफिट और मैच्योरिटी, आइदर ऑन डेथ और ऑन मैच्योरिटी. स्ट्रक्चर ऑफ पॉलिसी इज कॉम्बिनेशन ऑफ प्योर एंडोमेंट एंड टर्म अश्योरेंस. Term assurance is the life cover that I'm getting the policy, and pure endowment is the savings aspect, whatever maturity amount I will get. Premium will be for the risk premium plus savings element plus expenses. Risk premium is the mortality rate jo maine bataya. Savings element is the rest of the premium plus whatever jo expenses jo thode bahut karte hain wo usme kat jate hain. Now we come to annuities. So annuities mein kya hota hai ki ek when I reached a certain age and I feel that I might see what is the basic risk that a person faces, either they die too early or they live too long. These are the two main things. If you think of it, these are the two main reasons a person will more maybe want to make up savings for either for their family or for themselves. For themselves mein aata hai ki main retirement ke baad mein agar main bahut lambi tak jee jata hu to mere paas earning kuch nahi hai, I don't have any means of earning, how am I going to survive? 60 के बाद आई हैव रिटायर्ड फ्रॉम माई जॉब एंड आई डोंट हैव अ स्टेडी लाइन ऑफ इनकम कमिंग इन, बट आई नीड टू इफ आई एम गोइंग टू कीप ऑन लिविंग टिल द एज ऑफ 85 90 सो उस टाइम क्या होता है आपके मेडिकल एक्सपेंसेस भी बढ़ जाते हैं, आपकी अर्निंग्स भी खत्म हो जाती है. सो यू डू नीड टू प्लान फॉर योर रिटायरमेंट कि इफ आई लिव टू लॉन्ग व्हाट एम आई गोइंग टू डू, हाउ एम आई गोइंग टू मैनेज माई एक्सपेंसेस. फॉर सच पीपल वी हैव एन्युटीज वेयर अ सर्टन कैपिटल इज गिवन टू द इंश्योरेंस कंपनी. एक साथ में एक सर्टन सम ऑफ कैपिटल इज गिवन एंड इंश्योरर विल पे यू इन अ पीरियोडिक फॉर्म कि एनुअली आपको उसमें से वो एन्युटी मिलती जाएगी टिल द टाइम यू सर्वाइव. सो दीज आर व्हाट आर एन्युटीज. सो इन अ स्ट्रक्चर्ड वे लाइक से इफ आई वांट टू टेक एन एन्युटी प्लान तो आज मैं इंश्योरेंस कंपनी को 20 लाख रुपए एक साथ दे देती हूँ एंड इंश्योरेंस कंपनी विल टेल मी दैट यू आर गोइंग टू गेट प्रोबेबली 1.5 लाख रुपए एवरी ईयर स्टार्टिंग फ्रॉम नेक्स्ट ईयर ऑनवर्ड्स टिल द टाइम दैट यू आर अलाइव. देयर आर टू टाइप्स ऑफ एन्युटी प्लान्स, देयर इज इमीडिएट एन्युटी एंड देयर इज डिफर्ड एन्युटी. सो इमीडिएट एन्युटी इज कि मैंने एक साथ लमसम पैसे दिए एंड नेक्स्ट मंथ ऑनवर्ड्स या नेक्स्ट ईयर ऑनवर्ड्स व्हाटएवर यू हैव चोजन एन्युटी आपको मिलना चालू हो जाएगा. डिफर्ड एन्युटी इज कि आपने आज पैसे दे दिए क्योंकि आपके पास है बट यू वॉन्ट द मनी टू कम स्टार्ट कमिंग फ्रॉम मे बी 10 years लेटर. सो सपोज इफ आई एम 40 years ऑफ एज आई फील कि हाँ मेरे पास अभी पैसे हैं मैंने दे दिए पर मुझे अभी चाहिए नहीं क्योंकि अभी तो मैं कमा रही हूँ तो आई वॉन्ट द एन्युटी टू स्टार्ट कमिंग फ्रॉम एज ऑफ 60. सो दैट विल बी कॉल्ड डिफर्ड एन्युटी.
20 years से जो वो इन्वेस्ट हो चाहिए.
हाँ वो इन्वेस्ट होकर आपका मनी ग्रो हो रहा है इंश्योरेंस कंपनी के पास उसके बेसिस पे फिर वो आपको एन्युटी उतना बढ़ के मिलेगा.
तो ये जो 10 लाख जो इन्वेस्ट हो रहा है इसमें क्या फिक्स्ड इंटरेस्ट मींस दे कमिटेड एनी काइंड ऑफ फिक्स्ड इंटरेस्ट और
नहीं सो
लम सम
नहीं जब आप प्लान लेते हैं
इट डिपेंड्स ऑन मार्केट.
इट डिपेंड्स ऑन जिस टाइम आप प्लान ले रहे हैं उस टाइम जो मार्केट सिचुएशन उस हिसाब से वो एन्युटी अभी आज ही बता देंगे आपको कि 60 इयर्स की एज से आपको इतना एन्युटी मिलेगा फिर आप वो कैलकुलेट कर लीजिए कि कितना इंटरेस्ट मिल रहा
है. मतलब आप वो ठीक है वो एक भरभली बता दिया और एक रिटर्न कुछ
वो रिटर्न ही देंगे आपको पर वो इंटरेस्ट बेस्ड नहीं होगा. वो आज के दिन ही मुझे बता देंगे मेरी पॉलिसी में दैट दिस इज द अमाउंट ऑफ एन्युटी यू आर गोइंग टू गेट एवरी ईयर. वो चेंज नहीं हो सकता है चाहे मार्केट सिचुएशन कितना भी चेंज हो जाए 20 साल में.
हां सी 10 लाख जो किया उसका आपको 20 साल में ये 25 लाख और ये जो है ये दैट इज गारंटी. उसके ऊपर नीचे वो बात ऊपर वो बात अलग है लेकिन मिनिमम से ये आपका
ऊपर नीचे कुछ नहीं होगा जो फिक्स जो बता रहे वही मिलेगा. वही मिलेगा चाहे मार्केट सिचुएशन कैसा भी हो बहुत कम भी हो गया बहुत ज्यादा भी हो गया पर आपको जो उन्होंने बताया वही आपको मिलेगा. So this I have already said that this I have already explained. Now we come to bonus. What is the bonus aspect? What is the bonus? The distribution of the valuation surplus to policyholders is done through declaration of bonus. So in any life insurance policy, there is the sum assured, which is the fixed aspect, which is the life cover that they give. वो हमेशा guaranteed होता है. Bonus जो होता है वो आपका non-guaranteed होता है part होता है. That is dependent on the performance of the insurance company every year. So at the end of the financial year, insurance company declares a bonus on all their policies. So once they declare it, it forms a part of the policy. But that is can change every year because it is on the performance of the insurance company. So every year that can change. आज हो सकता है 3% बोनस उन्होंने डिक्लेयर किया, नेक्स्ट ईयर हो सकता है 2% करते हैं. सो लाइक आई सेड द बोनस इज डिक्लेयर्ड बाय द इंश्योरेंस कंपनी एवरी ईयर एज पर द परफॉर्मेंस ऑफ द इंश्योरेंस कंपनी. So that is a non-guaranteed part. It can vary from year to year. Some years it can be good depending on the performance of the company.
Correct.
Some years it can be a little lower if the company has not done very well. So there are two types of plans, participating and non-participating. So only the policies which have a participating plan will get the bonus. Non-participating plans are guaranteed plans. जहाँ पे आपका शुरू में ही declared रहता है कि आपको इतना amount मिलेगा. So there is no breakup of sum assured and what do we say, the bonus aspect. इसमें bonus का कुछ नहीं रहता है. Participating plans में bonus रहता है. Non-participating में आपको वो guarantee शुरू से ही बता देते हैं कि this is the amount you are going to get. Of course sum assured एक रहता है.
Like bond.
Sorry.
Like वो bonds जो
है. हाँ, similar, yes, sort of. कि वो शुरू से ही guaranteed आपको बताते हैं कि आपको इतना amount मिलेगा. So, declaration of bonus by the actuary has to be made after taking it into account elements like sum assured, age of the life assured, term of the policy and so on, which would mean that the contributions made by different kinds of policies for generation of the surplus is taken care of. The actuary tries to achieve the purpose by grouping the policies into different categories and declares bonus for each group separately. So, different kinds of policies will get different kind of bonuses. So, from LIC also. They have various categories of plans, you know. So different categories which they have grouped together will get different bonuses. It's not like a bonus declared by same bonus for all plans. It's not like that. Every category of plans will get different bonuses. What are the types of bonuses? You can get a simple revisionary bonus. That is like every year is declared and it gets added to the policy. Jitna bonus declared hua hai, add hua hai, uske upar aapko kuch extra benefit nahi milta hai. कंपाउंड रिविजनरी बोनस विल बी जिसमें आपका बोनस ऐड हो गया है उसके ऊपर भी आपको थोड़ा वो कंपाउंडिंग होता है, जैसे सिंपल इंटरेस्ट एंड कंपाउंड इंटरेस्ट होता है. देन देयर इज टर्मिनल बोनस एंड देयर इज इंटरिम बोनस. टर्मिनल बोनस इज एट द एंड ऑफ द पॉलिसी, जब मैच्योरिटी होती है या खत्म होती है पॉलिसी, तो एक लास्ट में भी इंश्योरेंस कंपनी कुछ एक बोनस दे सकती है. इंटरिम बोनस इज मिड टर्म ऑफ अ पॉलिसी व्हेन अ कंपनी डिक्लेयर सम काइंड ऑफ बोनस. Could be a celebration year, 100 years of or 25 years completed of a certain insurance company, they are declaring extra bonus of 2%, you know. That is an interim bonus that can be declared. Riders. There are various kinds of riders that can be taken, which is an additional benefit. That is an additional benefit, like briefly we have discussed earlier, like maybe like a partial disability or a permanent disability or a critical illness or accidental death. So these are all different kind of riders which can be taken over and above the base policy of yours.
Basically they are add-ons. Yeah?
Yes, these are all add-ons. Like say a vanilla ice cream on which you add maybe chocolate chips, or you add a wafer on top of that. You know, you add some cherries. So these are all those cherries and wafers and chocolate chips that you're adding to your vanilla ice cream, you know. Okay, so we are done with the traditional plans. We now come to the unit-linked plans. So, what is a unit-linked plan? Unit-linked plans are those plans which are, they are good for small investors who need liquidity and who are concerned of their safety. They are less, they don't have too much of a risk-taking ability and cannot diversify and lack expertise. So, basically, unit-linked plans are plans which are market-related. So, just like how your mutual funds work, जहाँ पे आप एक अपने फंड किसी एक म्यूचुअल फंड कंपनी को देते हैं, वेयर दे आर इन्वेस्टिंग योर मनी इनटू वेरियस डिफरेंट काइंड ऑफ स्टॉक्स और बंडल्स ऑफ स्टॉक्स, यू नो. सो हियर वी हैव अ यूनिट लिंक्ड प्लान्स विल बी यू आर पेइंग अ सर्टेन अमाउंट ऑफ प्रीमियम टू अ लाइफ इंश्योरेंस कंपनी. दे आर टेकिंग आउट द मोर्टैलिटी रेट फॉर दैट फ्रॉम दैट फॉर द लाइफ कवर दैट दे आर गिविंग यू एंड द रेस्ट दे आर इन्वेस्टिंग इन टू म्यूचुअल फंड्स. सो इट्स कॉम्बिनेशन ऑफ अ लाइफ कवर दैट यू गेटिंग प्लस अ म्यूचुअल फंड बेनिफिट, यू नो. So it's a bundle of both those two things. And they are good for small investors who actually do not know how to and where to invest, you know. And there are other few more benefits of unit-linked plans, which I will explain a little later. So there again, pooled investments works on the concept of pooling into a fund. There are returns linked to the markets. They are low-cost products. They are managed by experts. And they provide diversification to reduce risks, gives opportunity to invest regularly and reinvest, and they offer you liquidity. So market-linked insurance, which is unit linked insurance, will have a lock-in period of 5 years, after which you can withdraw at any point of time without any charges. So they are basically for small investors. Generally क्या होता है, people are of the opinion कि अगर मुझे अच्छे returns चाहिए तो मैं mutual funds में या stocks में directly invest कर देता हूँ. But उसमें क्या होता है, आपको life cover नहीं मिलती है, life cover नहीं मिलती है और आपको tax benefit नहीं मिलता है. Unit linked plans में आपको tax benefit भी मिलता है on both ends, like how all life insurance products have. And of course you can give the risks to the experts to manage for you without having to intervene yourself. And the premiums that you pay will get invested into the markets in various funds as chosen by you. So there are different kinds of funds that are available and you can invest in those funds. So they are of course pooled investments, and their investors are issued units based on their contributions. Exactly how mutual funds work, you know, कि आप जो पैसा डाल रहे हैं आपके लिए आपको units मिलेगा उसमें, and all gains are and losses are shared by the unit holders. The risk here entirely is borne by the insurance, the insured person. So we've already understood this, that the returns linked to market will be like mutual funds. And along with the life cover that you're getting. So what is the concept of mutual fund? Is the purpose to provide an opportunity to invest. No insurance coverage. Mutual funds में ये होता है कि आप invest कर रहे हैं पैसे, आपको insurance coverage नहीं मिलती है. Perspective of the fund manager is short term. Not necessarily, but generally. Regular and disciplined payments are a choice. Choice of the investor to benefit from rupee cost averaging. So this is what mutual funds offer us versus what and what are the advantages of mutual funds? Redemption allowed at any time. There is generally no lock-in period, maybe like say 3 years or something for tax saving mutual funds, but generally no lock-in period. Investors may benefit from short-term investments. Entry to and exit from the funds is based on the fluctuation in the financial market. Returns depend on entry and exit point in the market. A large portion of the portfolio is maintained in cash by the fund manager to maintain liquidity and allow for redemptions. So these are the advantages of a mutual fund. In unit linked insurance, the purpose is primarily is protection. आप कोई भी life insurance ले रहे हैं, it should always be with the purpose of first, primarily you should have the focus of taking life insurance, life cover. उसके बाद जो आपका इन्वेस्टमेंट, जैसी भी आपकी वट एवर योर माइंड सेट इज, एज पर दैट यू इन्वेस्ट द मनी आइदर इन ट्रेडिशनल फंड्स और इन यूनिट लिंक्ड फंड्स. अपॉर्चुनिटी टू अर्न हायर रिटर्न्स लिंक्ड टू मार्केट. सो यू ऑब्वियसली यू नो यू कैन गेट बेटर रिटर्न्स इन यूनिट लिंक्ड प्लान्स वर्सेस ट्रेडिशनल प्लान्स. ट्रेडिशनल प्लान्स विल जनरली गिव यू अ मैक्सिमम रिटर्न ऑफ बिटवीन 4-6%, वेयरएज इन यूनिट लिंक्ड प्लान्स, if you've invested for a fairly long period of time, say 15 to 20 years, you can estimate that you will get a return of at least 10-12%. Returns are based on the performance of the funds and it beats inflation. Because if we are going to get a return of about 12%, 10-12%, of course we are beating inflation. Whereas traditional plans will generally never be able to beat inflation. Unit linked plans, they are unique and they have various premium payment options. They have choice of investment funds. They give you a risk cover, which is a life cover, and they have top ups and withdrawals. So you can pay extra premium and top up your fund, and you can also withdraw time to time. Unit linked plans. The perspective of the fund managers is long term. See, when we are looking at of a unit linked plan, we are looking for a long term plan because life cover is primarily the main focus. तो हम अगर 5 साल के लिए, 7 साल के लिए, 10 साल के लिए लेते हैं तो लाइफ कवर भी आपको उतनी छोटी मिलती है. सो दैट डज नॉट मच मेक सेंस. सो वेन एवर समबडी डज टेक अ यूनिट लिंक प्लान ऑल्सो, दे शुड टेक इट फॉर अ लॉन्गर पीरियड ऑफ टाइम.
यूनिट लिंक प्लान क्या वो मींस उसका 5 इयर्स का ही लॉग इन है ना कि उसमें?
नहीं, मैं जब लेती हूँ प्लान तो आई कैन टेक अ प्लान फॉर 20 इयर्स. 5 साल अगर मेरे कंप्लीट हो जाते हैं, 5 साल के पहले अगर मैं निकलना चाहती हूँ प्लान से, देयर आर लॉट ऑफ सरेंडर चार्जेस एंड एवरीथिंग. वंस यू हैव कंप्लीटेड 5 इयर्स तो आप निकलना चाहें तो देयर इज नो चार्जेस. यू वांट टू कंटिन्यू, यू हैव द ऑप्शन.
मींस आई हैव ऑप्शन टू कंटिन्यू फॉर 3 इयर्स और 20 इयर्स.
जो मैंने प्लान शुरू में लिया है, इफ आई हैव टेकन द प्लान फॉर 20 इयर्स, आई हैव द ऑप्शन ऑफ कंटिन्यूइंग टिल 20 इयर्स.
उसका प्रीमियम क्या एवरी ईयर देना या वंस इन अ मींस वंस इन अ पॉलिसी?
नहीं, एवरी ईयर. आप एवरी ईयर दे रहे हैं. It's as per your choice what you have taken. It could be for that you have taken a plan where you have to pay for 10 years, policy will continue for 20 years.
Okay.
प्रीमियम आप 10 साल देके आपको आप प्रीमियम नहीं देना है बट पॉलिसी विल कंटिन्यू टू 20 इयर्स दैट चॉइस इज योर्स एंड एट द सेम टाइम इफ यू आफ्टर 5 इयर्स ऑफ कंप्लीशन यू कैन विथड्रॉ फ्रॉम द पॉलिसी एट एनी पॉइंट ऑफ टाइम जो आपका फंड वैल्यू है उस टाइम दैट इज व्हाट विल बी पेड टू यू सो अगेन द कॉन्सेप्ट अगेन इज वेरी सिमिलर टू ट्रेडिशनल प्लान्स इट्स अ पूल ऑफ मनी इज इन्वेस्टमेंट इज मेड ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ लार्ज नंबर ऑफ पीपल Investment is made for a specific class of assets. It is a diversified portfolio of securities. Has a fund manager who takes investment decisions. So you are not taking decisions. The fund manager is of course taking decisions on your behalf. The funds can be of different classes, equity, debt and cash. So based on your risk appetite or the person's risk appetite, the person chooses the fund that they want to invest.
Cash means?
Aapka liquid fund.
So cash means liquid,
liquid fund. Huh?
Debt fund means
debt will be less risky. Aapki government bonds hai, you know that. Just like how it is mutual fund. Equity will be obviously will be kya kehte hai aapka
the equity.
So the of course we all understand the higher the risk the higher the gain. Lower the risk lower the gain. आपका जितना आपका हायर आप इक्विटी में डालते हैं आपका रिस्क भी उतना ही है बट द चांसेस ऑफ गेनिंग इज आल्सो जस्ट दैट मच एंड इफ यू गो इनटू लिक्विड फंड्स तो आपका रिस्क भी कम है पर आपका गेन भी कम आएगा उसमें सो यूनिट की टर्म्स विल बी ऑफ कोर्स सम अश्योर्ड देयर इज बेसिक सम अश्योर्ड जस्ट लाइक ट्रेडिशनल प्लान्स सम अश्योर्ड आपका अगर लाइफ इंश्योरेंस है तो सम अश्योर्ड रहेगा ही रहेगा दैट इज योर लाइफ कवर विच इज गारंटीड सो इन यूनिट लिंक प्लान्स आल्सो सपोज मेरी पॉलिसी मैंने 20 साल की दी हुई है फर्स्ट फंड कैसे ग्रो होता है एवरी ईयर जो मैं पैसे डाल रही हूँ उसमें प्रीमियम डाल रही हूँ एक वो है एंड एक ग्रोथ है एस्पेक्ट है सो सपोज मेरा प्रीमियम हर साल का 1,00,000 रुपए है और मेरी मेरा सम अश्योर्ड 5,00,000 है या 10,00,000 है तो फर्स्ट ईयर आई पेड 1,00,000 मेरा फंड हो सकता है उसमें 97,000 कितना आएगा क्योंकि कुछ चार्जेस कट जाते हैं सेकेंड ईयर अगेन आई पेड 1,00,000 सो इट शुड बिकम 1,97,000 तो हो सकता है उसमें थोड़ा मार्केट ग्रोथ हुआ तो वो मेरा 2,05,000 आ गया थर्ड ईयर अगेन आई पे 1,00,000 सो इट शुड बिकम 3,10,000 और 20,000 और व्हाटएवर यू नो बट सम अश्योर्ड इज 10,00,000 सो इन केस आई डाई विद इन दोस 2-3-4 इयर्स मिनिमम व्हाटएवर ऑन डेथ व्हिचएवर इज हायर आइदर द सम अश्योर्ड और योर फंड वैल्यू दैट इज व्हाट विल बी पेबल व्हिचएवर इज हायर चाहे सम अश्योर्ड हायर है चाहे आपका फंड वैल्यू हायर है So if fund value is higher, you get paid fund value. But here the example that I've given you, here fund value is lower. So of course I will be paid the sum assured, which is 10,00,000 rupees. So these are the basic terms that are involved with it. Sum assured, risk cover, surrender, paid up, premium increase or decrease, death benefit, maturity benefit, top up, withdrawal, switching or redirection. So one big advantage of unit link plans is that you get to switch or redirect. आप जैसे म्यूचुअल फंड में होता है कि आपने अगर इक्विटी में इन्वेस्ट किया तो आप उसको चेंज करके आप डेट में नहीं ला सकते आपका एक बार वो स्टार्ट हो गया तो हो गया हियर यू हैव द ऑप्शन ऑफ स्विचिंग फ्रॉम डेट टू इक्विटी सो दिस इज वेरी गुड फॉर पीपल हु स्टडी द मार्केट यू नो यू कैन टाइम द मार्केट अगर आप दे से यू कैन नोबडी नोज एंड नोबडी कैन टाइम द मार्केट दैट इज वन थिंग बट एट द सेम टाइम अगर थोड़ा भी आप स्टडी करते हैं तो जब मार्केट आपका पता है कि परफॉर्मेंस सही नहीं चल रहा है तो आप उसको चेंज स्विच करके डेट फंड में ला सकते हैं या आप लिक्विड फंड में डाल सकते हैं बट वेन यू नो दैट द बेरिश है आपका मार्केट तो फिर आपका बुलिश है अगर आपका मार्केट तो आप उसको इक्विटी में डाल दीजिए तो आपका वो ग्रोथ ज्यादा आएगा सो यू गेट अ सर्टन नंबर ऑफ स्विचेज एवरी ईयर विच आर फ्री बियॉन्ड दैट इफ यू मेक स्विचेज उसमें थोड़ा कुछ कुछ चार्जेस करता है नॉट टू मच बट थोड़ा चार्जेस सो हाउ इज द स्ट्रक्चरिंग एंड वर्किंग ऑफ यूलिप इज दैट लाइक सम प्लान्स विल पे यू सम अश्योर्ड और फंड वैल्यू व्हिचएवर इज हायर बट देयर आर सम प्लान्स विच विल पे यू सम अश्योर्ड प्लस फंड वैल्यू सो दैट डिपेंड्स एंटायरली ऑन द टाइप ऑफ प्लान दैट यू हैव टेकन एट इंसेप्शन सो सरेंडर इन यूलिप्स मींस टर्मिनेटिंग द कॉन्ट्रैक्ट So whenever a person wants to surrender, they will get the fund value of the contract. So because there's no death happening at that particular time when you're surrendering, of course death benefit, jo sum assured that is immaterial. Whatever the fund value is at the time of termination is what the person will get. It could be lower than the sum assured in some cases. Agar aap jaldi terminate kar rahe. And like I said, 5 years ka lock-in hota hai generally unit link plans mein. If you surrender before 5 years, there will be surrender charges. After 5 years, there is no surrender charges in unit link policy. Withdrawals, partial withdrawals are allowed in from the fund, and partial withdrawals are allowed only after 5 years from inception. If the policyholder requires money for any financial contingency in between the policy term, facilities of partial withdrawals are helpful. जैसे हम ट्रेडिशनल प्लान में लोन्स ले सकते हैं, इसमें आप पार्शियली विद्रॉ ही कर सकते हैं, आपका फंड में से विद्रॉ हो जाता है
विदिन 5 years.
No, after five years. Switching, this is the process of transferring an investment from one fund to another, involves movement of money from one fund to another. Policyholder can switch to fund of his choice anytime depending on the market conditions. ये मैंने अभी just a little while ago explained. What are the types of funds that are available? There is debt fund, liquid fund, balanced fund and equity fund. So depending on the risk appetite of a person, you can choose whichever fund. And jitna higher aap grid ke upar jate hai, utna aapka risk involved jyada hota hai. Of course gains is also, rewards also you get as per that. Charges related to ULIPs, there is fund based charge, there are premium based charge, there are other charges. Premium based charge mein hota hai aapka, they are levied at the time of receipt of premium, they are deducted from the premium, they cover the cost related to acquisition of policy and is higher in the initial years. As the number of years keep passing, the premium based charges become lower and lower. Fund based charges are, they are levied at the time of computation of NAV, they are deducted on a daily basis and they cover the cost of managing the investment of funds. The other charges will be policy administration charges, mortality charges, switching and redirection charges and surrender charges. This is as and when whatever is applicable. The risk cover charges is the cost of the life insurance cover provided within the unit link plans. They are exclusive of all other charges in a unit link product. They are applicable at the beginning of each policy month. So on a monthly basis, mortality rate aapka fund mein se katta rehta hai.
Applicable at the beginning of the each policy month?
Yes. So mortality rate, जो आपका life cover का जो charges है, वो on a monthly basis it keeps getting deducted from the fund, from your the total fund, and yeah. So what are the differences between a traditional plan and a ULIP plan? One second. In terms of premium, in ULIP plans, the premium paid is used for buying units. Premium excluding allocation charges investment as desired by the policy holder. So in ULIP plans, जो भी हम premium pay करते हैं, तो allocation charges जो आपका एक mortality rate करके cut के आपका जितना बचता है premium, that is allocated as per whatever choice you make in whichever fund you have chosen, चाहे debt fund था, चाहे balance fund था, चाहे आपका equity fund था. आपने जो choose किया था the inception time pay, as per that, when after deduction of charges, it is invested in that particular portfolio. Whereas in traditional plans, the premium collected by policyholders go into a common fund and they invested at the insurer's discretion. Here, the insurer is not disclosing to you where they are investing. So it is not something that the insured person gets to know in traditional plans. Whereas in ULIP plans, because you are the one who has chosen where it is going to get invested, you are very well aware ki kahan pe invest ho raha hai. The amount of premium used for insurance coverage, other charges and the purchase of the unit is transparent and unbundled. क्योंकि इसमें आपको पूरा transparent, unit linked में आपको पूरा transparency रहता है, because they give you a breakup of what is getting deducted and where your money is getting invested. Whereas in traditional plans, the premium amount used for insurance coverage, charges and investment is bundled and not known to the policyholder. इसमें आपको breakup नहीं पता चलता premium का कि where and how, where they are investing, how much is getting deducted for mortality. वो एक आपका एक total आपका वो premium जिस हिसाब से बनता है वो बताते हैं. So in terms of policy conditions, ULIPs में partial withdrawals are allowed, surrender is allowed after 5 years, and if there could be a profit or a loss in the policy depending on the NAV, and loans are allowed in ULIPs. So in traditional plans, partial withdrawals are not allowed. Surrender is allowed, but there is a huge loss if a person surrenders a traditional plan versus a ULIP plan. And in traditional plans, loans may or may not be provided depending on the policy that you have taken. In terms of bonus and benefit, There are no bonuses in ULIP plans except loyalty bonus in some cases, whereas there is a, in traditional participating plans, there is a bonus aspect. In ULIP plans, policyholder is responsible for the benefits under the policy and not the insurer. Benefits are variable because it is completely market-related. In traditional plans, benefits are predetermined. आपको ऑलरेडी पहले से ही पता होता है कि आपका बोनस जो है वो वेरिएबल होता है बट आपका सम अश्योर्ड फिक्स होता है. सो एंड बोनस में भी वेरिएबिलिटी इतना ज्यादा नहीं आता है, तो देयर प्रीटी मच नॉन वोलेटाइल एंड यू नो राइट फ्रॉम द बिगिनिंग व्हाट यू गोइंग टू गेट इन द पॉलिसी. इन टर्म्स ऑफ इन्वेस्टमेंट रिटर्न्स इन यूलिप, रिस्क इज कंप्लीटली द इंश्योर्ड पर्सन एंड इट डिपेंड्स ऑन द मार्केट. Whereas in traditional plans, there are two categories of benefit, guaranteed and non-guaranteed. Guaranteed will be the sum assured, non-guaranteed will be the bonus. In ULIP plans, the gain and the loss in the policy value depends on market movement, and in traditional plans, there is no link to market. And we come to the end of our presentation. So if we have any questions, we may take that now.
Participating में जैसे आपने बताया कि उसमें bonus component आता है.
Right.
नॉन पार्टिसिपेटिंग में मतलब बोनस नहीं रहता है, तो इन फर्स्ट प्लेस में ये जानना चाह रहा था कि ये है, ऐसा है क्यों, कि अब अगर बेसिकली है कि अगर कोई पार्टिसिपेटिंग या नॉन पार्टिसिपेटिंग दोनों में अगर ये चीज है तो फिर ये है क्यों, ये
सर बेनिफिट ऑफ द इंश्योर्ड के लिए है ना. ये अगर नॉन पार्टिसिपेटिंग है तो आज के दिन नॉन पार्टिसिपेटिंग में ऐसे प्लान्स हैं कि मुझे अभी से पता वो गारंटी करके दे रहे हैं कि आपको नेक्स्ट 25 इयर्स तक आपको इतना परसेंटेज ऑफ द प्रीमियम हर साल मिलेगा. तो मेरे लिए दैट इज अ बेटर थिंग देन स्टेइंग इन अ पार्टिसिपेटिंग प्लान वेयर सी व्हाट इज हैपनिंग इज आई एम नॉट वेरी श्योर ऑफ हाउ LIC इज गोइंग टू परफॉर्म इन द नेक्स्ट 10 इयर्स 20 इयर्स 30 इयर्स. सो बोनस देयर इज अ पॉसिबिलिटी दैट द बोनस कैन कीप गोइंग डाउन डाउन डाउन, यू नो देयर इज अ पॉसिबिलिटी इट कैन इंक्रीज. The higher likelihood is कि वो और नीचे होता जाए, कि जितना competition बढ़ेगा, जितना performance होता है, एक बार एक saturation आ जाएगा तो हो सकता है growth उतना ज़्यादा नहीं हो रहा है कोई company के अंदर. तो participating plan में bonus aspect variable है, maybe variability will not be very high, but then that variability is there. Whereas versus a guaranteed plan where I'm already sure that I'm going to get this percentage. If I am already being guaranteed, then I will get a return of 6.5% in a particular policy. Then why not go for that? And It is the insured person's choice which kind of a plan. Both are available in the market. Which
better, better कौन सा होगा आपके आपके अनुसार?
Right now in the market, guaranteed plans बहुत अच्छे बने हुए. Guaranteed plans is what we are suggesting right now.
Non-participating.
Because वहाँ पे already आपको declared है कि आपको इतना मिलेगा. उसमें already आपको 6.5% का return अगर मिल रहा है, IRR मिल रहा है, तो why should I go for a participating plan where there is uncertainty कि मुझे उतना return मिलेगा कि नहीं मिलेगा? So it's better to go for guaranteed plans, which is fine. So any other questions? Otherwise we can
wrap up
this presentation.